Hey! We don't serve their kind here.
What?
The droids, they left to wait outside. We don't want them.
Hello and welcome to the Vintage Rebellion podcast. This is episode 80, Sinterklaas is coming to town. And I barely sing, so there's a bit of a treat for you this one. I'm your host.
Singing?
That was me singing, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I'm Richard Hutchinson and I'm your host for this month. And joining me as always is Peter Davis. Good evening, Pete.
Why are you Richard, man?
Now, Pete, it's a special day for you, so me and all the guys are going to join in by singing you happy birthday right now, and you can join in if you want.
More singing. Oh,
happy birthday to you.
Oh, dear.
Happy birthday to you. Hey, Pip.
Hooray!
Now, Peter, but you've never had your birthday ever sung to you like that before without anybody touching a drop of alcohol.
Well, I don't know, a few you sound drunk.
Anything nice for your birthday, Pete?
I got a tape player.
Oh, wow, a tape player. It's just what everybody wants in 2021.
Yeah. Well, I've got loads of... Well, we're going to newest acquisitions of ourselves, but I got a bunch of tapes. I've been hoovering up Star Wars tapes, so yeah, I needed a tape player for all those vintage tape playing days. So there, Rich. Yeah.
And next on the list is Andy Spoons Norton. Good evening, Andy.
Evening, Rich.
Andy, what's the weather been like in Sheffield over the last few days? Because it's been horrific up here.
I've not left the house. Went out this morning. The roads are running with water. They were like rivers. It's crazy. Someone like the hills are just a giant sponge, but yeah, it's nice today though. Bit windy but sunny.
And it's good evening, Jason Smith.
Good morning, Emmanuel. How you doing, Rich?
I'm doing fine. Now, Jason, Monday 25th, Burns Night. What are you doing on Burns Night this year?
I will be eating haggis and clap shot in the house by myself with the missus, I guess.
No, you're not going to be by yourself then, are you?
That is true.
And finally, we have Andy Preston. Good evening, Andy.
Good evening, Rich. Good evening, everyone.
Andy, did you catch anything good on TV or the festive period?
No.
Okay.
No, it's rubbish, isn't it, at the moment?
Absolutely. Ones for Netflix would all be crawling up the walls, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yes, I did. Cobra Kai. That was good. There you go. Cobra Kai, but that's it.
Yep, absolutely. I agree with Cobra Kai. Yep, that was really good. Right, well, first show of 2021. So we usually start 2021 by discussing what we expect to happen in the next year ahead. So I'm going to come to you first, Pete. As well as giving us your latest purchases, what are your targets of 2021? What are you hoping for?
Well, since my birthday, Rich, I think you should be buying me all this stuff that I want.
Oh, Pete, I have actually coincidentally sent you a parcel.
What?
Yes. It might be there with you tomorrow. Incredibly coincidental. It wasn't a birthday gift.
Oh, that old story, Rich. You should have my birthday in your little secret diary so you can, preempt it. I bet you did, really. You're just playing, hard to get kind of thing.
Yeah, I play hard to get. Yeah, definitely.
Right. So, Rich, I'll go very quickly, unlike the rest of them. I've just four comics to get in the 326 Marvel comics, just four to go. So I bought a bunch of those. I got some random open tops Empire Strikes Back blue wax packs all open. There's like three versions of the blue ones with some different typeface on. They're really cheap, so I'll have them. I got the Marvel Comics Summer Special for 1984, which I was quite chuffed at. really good condition as well. And I got a bunch, as I mentioned earlier, a load of audiobooks, the old EU ones, and some of the radio dramas on tape, cassette. I thought that's a nice little side bit of fun to have. So getting back into those old EU dramas. And the usual tons of Amidala stuff and loads of alien figures on that new Super 7 Funko range, which are really cool, because there's a lot of alien stuff at the moment. So that's going back to the early 80s. That's kind of vintage in its own way, in a kind of modern way. Do you want my targets then for the next year?
Yep, go straight into them, Pete. I'm getting excited. Stay on target.
Well, believe it or not, Rich, with four to go, I'm hoping I'm going to finish that run this year. There's probably going to be still a bit hard if I haven't got shows to go to, but that's the target. A couple of little mini rigs. I realised I didn't actually have a radar dish or a laser cannon, so I was a bit surprised I didn't have those. I mean, they're quite easy to get hold of, so I thought, okay, I'll just get them loose. I couldn't believe I didn't have them. I think I've got all the other mini rigs apart from the skiff, and I thought, well, I wasn't a massive mini rig fan, but those are the cool mini rigs. And then I want to really sort of delve deep into more kind of hand carbonite freeze chamber things, I think, with printing on with those things. I think I've obviously want to try and get hold of a Bestman freeze chamber, the micro collection one. If I could somewhere, I wouldn't mind a beaten up version of the Cloud City playset. I know they're ridiculously expensive, but sometimes you see that just bits of the cardboard come up. So the bit with the freeze chamber, I wouldn't mind getting hold of that. A Dewback. I don't have a Dewback. I wouldn't mind one of those. I know that they're not ridiculously hard to get hold of. And I would love, and I've kind of got a few bits. I might actually have to spend some money and get a 12-inch loose Leia in the box. Not particularly that bothered by the box, but I'd like a complete loose Leia 12-inch. So modest targets, Richard, modest targets. Obviously, you know, keep adding to my little focuses I've got going on. But yeah. That's me, really. Well, you, Rich, come on.
Yeah.
Your list is pretty small, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yes, all easily achievable, those, Pete. But, yeah, getting them for the right price, that's what you're after. You like your bit of bargains.
Yes.
Right, well, my latest acquisitions, I don't think so, picked anything up in the last month. I certainly don't remember anything. The first year I've not been part of a Secret Santa or anything at all. For
not even
a
any
long
tats.
Time.
I mean, no kids bought you tats.
Oh, I got the Stormtrooper BRs for my daughter, but I didn't like them. They were absolutely disgusting. And somebody else bought me a bottle of Stormtrooper IPA. I think it was a colleague from work, but other than that, I didn't get any Stormtrooper. No, because I'm starting to tell them now, stop buying me Star Wars crap. And I think they're finally starting to take the hint when they see it in charity boxes, maybe 3 weeks later. So, yeah.
To be fair, I just remembered, actually, I did get a little bit of Star Wars tat at Christmas. I got a Funko Pop Luke and Tauntaun that someone bought, which is quite nice, actually, in its own way. It's quite a nice little piece. There's that guy who did the Stormtrooper stuff, who designed the Stormtrooper thing. There's a whole range of his stuff out there. And my niece bought me the one part of the three monkeys, kind of, you know, hear no evil, see no evil, and it's Stormtrooper instead of monkeys, but only bought one of them. So I thought, okay, that's a bit random. So that's going in the next bargain bin. And a Chewbacca nightlight. Yeah, because that's just what I'm into.
Definitely.
So there's three things for the bargain bin, Rich. Mm. So we can raffle those off.
Yeah, possibly at some point. I don't think I've got anything. Targets for 2021, well, my biggest target now is to focus on my streamlining. I'm doing really, really well. I've actually, my collecting room, which was going to be the collecting room, which was taken over by the daughter, has actually been gutted. And the only thing that's up there at the moment is my Star Wars stuff. There is nothing in that room at all. So I'm really, really pleased that I've finally done that. I'm doing well on streamlining. I've got rid of loads of rubbish. I have taken hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of modern items down to Vectus over the last week. So they've been dropped off of there, and Nick Dice just looked at us and he went, "For real?" And I just went, "Sorry, Nick, I have tagged and bagged them all, so it's up to you, get them flogged on my behalf." Focusing on streamlining. Wish list, I'm not actually particularly looking for anything at the moment, but I do need to get back into the EU, because I do love the expanded universe, the books, the novels, the comics, you know. I've got to get back into that. And I've taken my eye off the ball the last two or three years.
The audiobooks, Richard, the audiobooks.
They are amazing. I have got Oh, I've probably got about 50 of them on my hard drive somewhere. But they are so good. I think a lot of them are read by Dennis Lawson, if I remember right. And some of them are read by... I think it's one of the guys off the Carry On films who does... is it Alan... I'm going back 15 years
I've
now. Alan Dale. I think it's Alan Dale does a lot of them.
From Digby Henry as well. Thomas. Henry Thomas has read a lot of them.
If only it was Kenneth Williams.
Yeah. But yes, the audiobooks are excellent because they've got they've got sound effects and you can be driving down the motorway and you're having the X-Wings flying by. They're absolutely good. They're really, really well done. I think the problem with the audiobooks, Pete, I think, is that they've got the pronunciations of some of the characters wrong. I said, that Timothy's Arm was quite a big critic of how his characters were pronounced in the audiobooks because he said he was never consulted at all. And that's a bit of a shame because it does irritate me when you get like a name in your head of how it's pronounced and then somebody else pronounces it in a completely different way. That's a bit of a pain in the bum. But yeah, completing my EU is definitely on my wish list.
That's like listening to you, Richard. You pronounce things all over the place in EU.
I do.
Bloody Geordie.
Absolutely, yeah. It was interesting when you come to hear our interview this month. I think I'm probably the one who has the worst English. We'll see. Jason, moving on to Jason then. So come on then, Jason, hit with a big boy.
Let me just get a seat and a cup of tea so we can listen to this.
Yeah, Rich, come put your dinner on. Right, here we go. So what have I had over the Christmas period? I start off with a couple of tri-logo card backs with a WH Smith bargain only price sticker on it. And those look really nice, and those look very well complemented with... There was a couple of tri-logo card backs I got that had the Woolworths reduced price sticker on them. So I've got WH Smith ones to go with the art rails. I'm very happy with those. As was revealed on our video-only segment in last month's podcast, I did open my HCF Return of the Jedi fancy set. So I've got one of those, which I'm very happy with. On HCF, I've also filled up my Record Erasers box, so I've got all of those. I've got the HCF Return of the Jedi scrapbook, the big ones. I've got one of those now. I've got some more rectangular-centered erasers. I'm going for... two full sets of those, so you can display them front and back. And when I do get a box, there'll be enough just to fill the top layer of a box. So there is plan in my madness there. I've got some more HCF Darth Vader pencil toppers. I've got another box of pencil toppers, which I'm trying to fill up. So I've got that. I've got the blue flat pencil case to go with the yellow flat pencil case I've got. So I've got two of those, one more to get in red. On to Marvel. I finally got Marvel Return of the Jedi Weekly, the last two issues, issues 154 and 155. So I have a full set, and I'm thinking everything's complete on Marvel, but I've gone through them all, and I've looked to see what freebies I'm missing, because a lot of the comics came with free bits and bobs, and I'm missing about five of the freebies on Return of the Jedi, so I'm going to go and collect those. So the first of those arrived today, and it's basically issue number 73 comes with a free sticker poster. And on the poster, you get free fun product stickers in the following two weekly episodes, 74 and 75, that you stick in all four corners. So I've got that poster filled in. So I might try and get one that's mint without them filled in, but I've got one of those so far, and I've got another four issues to go. On to Addis, which is my the British kind of... bubble bath and soap range. I've got the R2-D2 bubble bath bottle, which leaves me leading Han, Chewbacca, and the almost impossible to get Leia. So I've got that. I've got a pack of shower gel, sponge and soaps featuring Darth Vader and Luke. And then I've got some of the character soaps, one featuring R2-D2 and C-3PO. And the other one featuring Darth Vader and Luke. So that leaves me leading a larger pack of Ewok stuff and then Ewok character soaps. I'm still looking for those. My Black Hole collection, which was mentioned on the video segment that we did in the last podcast, I've collected a set of first day covers, either featuring the Palitoy Diamond Jubilee logo on one of them, or they had a special stamp, which they put on first day covers that featured it was in 1983, I think, International Year of the Child. So I've got about 7 or 8 of those, which are all very nice. Stefan Farcourt, Jan LaRue sent me a pile of French Touch promotional materials. I have a collage on my wall, which I've had for many years now, which features all of their promotional material. And they sent me a pack of all their latest stuff. So I had to expand out my wall and make it longer, so wider, so I've got more of their stuff on display. It looks really nice. And then on my non-vintage purchase from Christmas, I did get a lot of Christmas stuff, like we all do, but I got a Baby Yoda Christmas jumper. So there's a picture of me wearing my Baby Yoda Christmas jumper. I've got Star Wars pajama bottoms on, and then my Baby Yoda kind of slanky thing I'm wearing is a cape. So I look like Star Wars Christmas Man was the quote, which I posted on Facebook. So I'll be sure to make sure that one features in the images that go along with the podcast. It's quite a sight. Targets for 2021. I say I've got this cabinet for HCF, which is about half full. So I want to put a lot more HCF items on there. I've still got an awful lot to get. Would like more Palitoy paperwork items for my folder of paperwork. I'd like a new Palitoy catalogue or price list. There's several price lists I don't have. I'd like to fill up my Helix pencil topper box. I probably need about another half dozen pencil toppers to fill that up. I'd like to finish my Addis run on soaps and bubble baths, bar the layer bubble bath. And I'd like an ESB FKS sticker box to go along with my ESB album. I'd like to make more progress on a few of my foreign card back runs. I haven't really done very much with my foreign card back runs in the last year, so I'd like to kind of focus on that again. And I'd like a new Palitoy card back. I mean, I've got almost everything on Palitoy card backs, so either a new one for my collection or a new one discovered would be equally as nice. So either one for the collection or just one that I know exists. That would be wonderful. And then the wish list, I've kind of put things which are really hard possible that I'm just never going to get. So they're on my wish list. I need a Clearo Imperial Cruiser bubble bath and shampoo to finish my Clearo run. I need that Leia bubble bath bottle to finish my Addis run, probably. On Letraset Stationery, there's a promotional... it's called Letraset Stationery and Transfers from Letraset. It's a little book that they did a show. They're very rare and very hard to get hold of. I'd like a new Helix display box. Helix display boxes are rare as hen's teeth, very hard to get. I really like one of those. And then Palitoy did a couple of Palitoy versions of the Planets poster set on the 3D poster art set, which normally you get branded as Kenner. There are Palitoy versions. Again, they're rare as hen's teeth. It'd be lovely to have one of those. And then major Palitoy card backs. There's a 12C C3PO card back that I know exists. I know there's one of those. I'd love one of those. And then a Palitoy 12A Deskord Commander. I know two of those exist in card back form. Love to get my hands on one of those. And to finish my Canadian GDE 12C run, that's the one with the big Guerre de la Toy logo at the top that's shaped like a pyramid. I've got 11 of them. I just need a Chewbacca, but again, Chewbacca is just rare as hen's teeth, so that's my wish list as well. And Rich, your dinner's probably burning at this point. You better go and check how it's doing.
A lot of hens there.
Plenty of hens.
With a lot of teeth.
Indeed.
Good list that, Jason, and good luck in hunting some of that down. Let's move over to Andy Preston then, because look, the show notes here, you've got a fair few items as well this month.
I have, Rich. I didn't think I bought that much, but obviously the last podcast was recorded before Christmas, so this goes back to stuff that I bought before Christmas. So when you add it all up, there is a bit of a list, almost Jason-esque proportions, so I'll try and whiz through it fairly quickly. Lots of random stuff. So the first one, a Wokling, Nippet the Wokling. This is a loose unboxed, which is how they were sold for a while in Europe. So this still has the hanging tag and the Palitoy cardboard tag on it, so unused. I've got a set of instructions for the Dennis Fisher large size R2-D2. Never actually knew those existed until these popped up on eBay. So that completes my R2. A couple of ILM crew patches from episode 1, Jar Jar Binks and Boss Nass. With the accompanying paperwork. There's a set of nine of those, so I've got six of the nine now. A Return of the Jedi video store display poster, which would have been up on the wall in British video stores. That was an upgrade to a rather tatty one I had. A dressing gown, a lovely dressing gown from Penshiel UK with a big Star Wars logo and Star Wars imagery. A lot of their clothing, their pajamas and their dressing gowns and so on featured Luke in his orange X-Wing pilot outfit. Really stands out nicely, so lovely graphics on that one. I got three badges. Found these again on eBay. Badges with Empire Strikes Back characters, but with the Star Wars logo, so Star Wars TM. I thought they were bootlegs. Got them back, and then I actually saw there was writing around the edge, copyright, a company called Apple Egg. Looked them up, and turns out that they're a Dutch company, and there was a range of, is it 10 or 12? I forget. Anyway, they did a range of Empire Strikes badges, so I got three of those. A fancy stationery set like Jason. These come in different kinds. I've already got one with a yellow inner tray liner. This one's got the red inner tray with different contents. And I need to do a little bit of work on these just to find out what versions were available and see whether there's any more of those that I'm lacking. Star Wars Punch Out and Make It book from 1978. This is the British version by Collins. A couple of the models that you can punch out and make have indeed been punched out and made. So it's not complete, but it's still a very rare item. Pleased to have one of those. Upgraded my Deco Star Wars Party Tablecloth set. That's a set mint in the bag. A couple of cassette tapes. Music from Star Wars and Close Encounters by Gerhardt with the National Film Orchestra. And The Sounds of Star Wars by Bruce Baxter and the Sonic All-Stars, adding to my little cassette collection. A couple of fan club, a Lucasfilm fan club patch and a Star Wars fan club patch. The one with the Star Wars logo. It's a black background with the white logo on it. A bit of a highlight, this one. A Palitoy Boba Fett offer flyer. Been after one of these for years. This is a very, very rare flyer that would have been handed out in toy shops in 1980. And it's basically two-sided flyer, picture of Fett on the front, and on the rear, the instructions to send off your three character names to get you free Boba Fett. Massive thanks to Narayan on Facebook, who pointed me to the auction on eBay. Came from the States. So really, really pleased to add that one. And last but not least, a copy of Plug Comic from March 1978 with a Star Wars cover. Don't know whether you remember Plug. He was one of the Bash Street Kids in the Beano comic. And oh, for yes. A little while in the 70s, he had his own comic. So this one, the only thing to do with Star Wars is a cover, but it's based on the original Star Wars poster art. So you've got Plug standing in the center holding up what looks like a lightsaber with a sort of star effect coming off it. You've got some weird looking creature with a Darth Vader helmet standing over him. You've got a couple of droids, R2-D2, like a dustbin. So yeah, that's really nice derivative.
Andy, I think there's a little bit of self-portrait in there, to be fair, with Plug. I think the reason it resonates with you so much is because you identify with him.
Little known fact there, yes, Plug was actually based on me. So
there we go, look at that.
Yeah, there we are. Nice little connection there. Thank you, Pete. And the other thing that I received, which was actually a Christmas present, an IKEA Detolf cabinet. Well, hey! Haven't been able to display my collection for years and years, and always been fancying a cabinet. So yes, finally got a cabinet. It's up in the hallway. So I've already had two lots of stuff in it. I first of all had my run of action figures, loose figures in there, looking lovely, and swapped them out this last weekend for a set of random stuff. So some of the stuff that's arriving in the post, some of my cassettes and some fan club patches and the ILM episode one patches and a few other bits of tat. So yeah, really loving that. So the idea, because I've only got that one cabinet, I'm going to swap it around every few weeks, have some different stuff on there, and yeah, really get back to enjoying my collection on display for a bit. So yeah, well chuffed to have that.
How many years is it going to take you to get your whole collection through that cabinet?
About 312, I think. So yeah, watch this space. Targets for 2021. What would we like to do? Well, top of that list has to be, let's get back to going out, let's get back to meeting each other, toy fairs, conventions, location trips, whatever. Let's get back out there and let's have some fun again. Here's hoping. I think it's going to be late on in the year. It's going to be sort of second half of the year, but you never know. If we can all stay safe, all look after each other, get that jab, then I hope we can look to meet up towards the end of the year. On the collect side, I'd like to finish either my Helix or my Frankel and Roth. They did the bags and pencil cases in the UK. And or HCF runs. Not a lot needed for all of those, so that's potentially achievable. I would like to add a significant vintage cast and crew piece and also a significant British store display piece. I think that's fairly achievable. And I would also like to get the last on my list of Palitoy diecast. I'd like to get an X-Wing mint on card. A good reseal would be okay, or one with a bit of a battered bubble. But that's the last one of those that I need. And then my wish list, what would I really love to have? I would love to have a Star Wars yellow crew t-shirt. This is the one that you see in some of the behind the scenes images. Yellow t-shirt with the Macquarie triangular logo and the Star Wars writing on. Really iconic t-shirt. I've got a transfer from ILM for one of those, but I've not got the t-shirt itself, so that would be a lovely one to add. And then display boxes. Well, I've got a little list. I'd love to have a Topps Empire Strikes Back initial stickers box. I'd love to have a Tavern of Rutledge Mallow Shapes Star Wars box. The aerial balloons that were released for Return of the Jedi, I'd like to have that one. Or just about any Helix or Letraset store display box. So whether any of those will ever pop up, we're back to Jason's hen's teeth again. But it'd be really nice to snack one of those this year. That's me done.
Wow, seems a long time since I introduced this section. And we've still got one more to go. And Pete stole my joke because I was going to introduce spoons as being the life-size equivalent of plug. But come on, spoons, take it away.
You can always edit that and put me at the beginning, Rich, for that hilarious gag there. Well, you'll be pleased to know that it's been another quiet month for me. I've had a few busy ones, but normally I don't buy that much. And then a little thing. So a couple of Takara Keshigomu rubber toys, TIE Fighter and a Darth Vader TIE Fighter. The colour combinations of those are coming on nicely. Like the others, Return of the Jedi Weekly got number 133. So a few more for me to get there. And my first Letraset exercise book, which is the C-3PO one. And then just yesterday, so I thought this might be on to next month's latest acquisitions, but just yesterday, the sort of strip of Letraset Star Wars stickers that came with Wall Sausages arrived, which is a nice little run. But I think the best thing that I got since the last podcast was some new LED lights for my cabinet. So over Christmas, had a couple of days in the collecting room, taking everything off the shelves, reorganized and put those lights on, and that was great. Target-wise, Target's pretty much the same as last year, which I did nothing towards, which was putting together a run of the loose 12-inch. Now, I had a run of these over 10 years ago now, which I sold not long before we moved up to Sheffield. And I must say, the prices of 12-inch at the moment are really putting me off. You have these sort of artificial prices in your head of how much things cost, and 12-inch seems to have rocketed in the last couple of years. So that much as I would like to put a run of 12-inch figures together, I suspect I'm going to be too tight to do so, but I'm keeping my eyes peeled for cheap, maybe incomplete ones. I haven't bought many die-cast things recently. I put together most of the runs of the carded ships, but more for the website rather than for me, I would like to get better photos of the box ships, so the Falcon, Imperial Cruiser, and Y-Wing in various of those boxes. So I'm keeping my eyes peeled for those, but no great rush. And the ones I think I would like to do and are achievable is to get the last Letraset for that run of 10, that's number 9, and finish my Marvel run. I'm a little bit behind Pete and Jason with their runs. So I've got 10 to get for the Return of the Jedi Marvel comics. That's my targets for 2021. And understandably,
for the wish list, the Letra set, you know, that's as hen's teeth has been mentioned by everybody. That number 9 seems to be like hen's teeth at the moment. Got loads of number 2s. I'm happy to swap, but no number 9. And I will find those comics, but it is easier out in person. But the ones that a lot harder to find, and you know, I'll snap these up if ever I see them. The Meccano diecast tie. I've never seen a sealed one of those. I'd absolutely love one. That would finish my TIE fighter run. And lastly, you mentioned the box ships earlier. The Empire Strikes Back packaging for those, for the diecast ships. I'd like the run of 3 of those. They're on my wish list, but I suspect I won't be getting any of those for 2021.
I must admit, swapping number 2s with you, Andy, isn't really high on my priority. But some great items there, lads. You've done really, really well picking things up, and I'm looking forward to seeing you achieve your targets for 2021. Right then, Pete, main topic for this month, you've put the title in there, One Red Paperclip. I think we all know what this story's about, but why don't you lead with this, and let's see if we can get this one taken off the ground, because this has tried to have happened quite a few times now.
Yeah, I think we mentioned it a few times, but it's always like, oh, you know, how do we start it off? So I thought, come on, let's start. Might as well do something at the start of the year and try and keep it running through the whole of the year. So it's no excuse. So if you've got some old tat out there you want to swap with us, then get it out and have a think. So the story is, there was a guy in Canada years ago, and he thought, right, what I'll do, I want to get a house. I haven't got any money. So can I generate a bunch of swap deals using an item? And he decided to go with a big red paperclip because it was, you know, kind of useful. And so can he transfer it for, so can he trade it for a house? And he did. I mean, if you look at the, if you go and do a little Google search of it, there's some amazing trades in there, including a part in a film, a recording contract, all sorts of crazy stuff. Now, obviously, we don't go that mad. The target would be to, by the end of the year, have something really, really cool, so we can, you know, raffle it off for cash. So the way it would go is, every month, we'll ask people to put trades up for the item we have. We'll assess those and reveal what we're going to trade it for in the next podcast. So I've got a few bits and pieces. I thought, well, you know, if the guy's got anything to offer, I've got a couple of things. I've got very, very, very nice Admiral Ackbar vintage figure, which could be quite nice without the weapon, sadly. I've got a Mead folder, Star Wars Mead folder, very good condition. It's not worth that much, about a tenner, but it's nice. It's all with Princess Leia on and Luke Skywalker. Or I've got a couple of pillowcases, really, really big ones with Star Wars on it. I think they came out about Return of the Jedi kind of time, about 83, 84.
Now, what have I got to? I've not really given this much thought. I've got some beta figures lying about. You know, there's some loose figures, weapons. What about, I know what I've got that's quite interesting. The Takara Woodkit TIE Fighter. How about that?
Crikey, if you wanted to offer that up, Andy, then that's a good start.
Yeah, I'll offer that up.
Yeah, our start point. Well, I think we've start there. And we can just ignore what the rest of them say, because there's no way they're going to beat that, are they? Let's face it. I don't know, actually. I reckon we could start with a certain item that Mr. Preston got last month. A lovely coat, I believe you could offer up as the first item. What do you reckon, Andy? You don't need it, do you?
Still a bit cold around these parts, PTO. I might need to wrap myself up. Getting old now.
Have you worn it yet?
Only very briefly. Not out.
Has that taken 20 grand off the price? Or
yeah. That's added to it, Pete. Come on.
Well, yeah, I guess so. Well, can you come up with anything better to start off with than that Takara wooden?
I don't think I can. I was the thing I had in mind I was going to suggest was a Star Wars gatefold double LP, the first one with the inserts and the poster and things like that. But I think the Takara wood kit probably trumps that, doesn't it?
Oh, I think so.
That's a nice item, though, Andy. I would, I'd like. Well, I've got one of those, but if I didn't, I would like one of those.
Why don't you trade? We'll start from there.
Yeah.
Jason, what about your entire Marvel run? Come on, you've done it now. You must be bored of it by now.
No, I haven't finished, because I've got to fill in all those missing free gifts. So what can I offer up? So we discussed in the last podcast the fact that Gary Smith had got the first ever Palitoy 41 back Sand People mint on card, and that had come out of the Aston's auction. Now, several years ago, I had the very first Palitoy card back of that, and it was the only one known to exist. And then another one turned up, so there were two, and then there was a mint on card. But there is a fourth example, and I have another card back of the 41 back, but the name tag is cut out. But to a Sand People Tuscan Raider collector, I can bet you that they won't have that, and that it would be a very desirable thing. So I'm prepared to offer that up.
Ooh. Crikey. I can hear myself coming back through some of the speaker. But anyway, that's very generous, Jace. I think we might have to keep your powder dry on some of these. We might have to come back to them later on.
Do you want an HCF pencil topper?
No, that's a great start.
I think that would probably be a better start, to be honest with you. But, yeah, okay, well, I think we should start with that. Hold those other items, though, guys, because that might be later.
I'll still offer that up at some point, so that's not going anywhere.
Because if we get stuck for a trade, which we probably will do at some stage, then we can shove one of those in to up the ante, because I think let's start small to see what we can get for the topper. Which one, Jason? Big Fortuna, sounds good.
Yeah, and he's topical as hell, isn't he, with the Book of Boba Fett, whatever it's called.
Yeah, but they killed him off after 2 minutes. Which was really annoying, actually. But there we go.
Which one looks in better nick? Oh, that one looks in better nick. There you go. So you want a Bib Fortuna HCF pencil topper.
There we go. Right. That's our trade. Anyone out there who can trade up from that, if you want a Bib Fortuna pencil topper, what can you offer? Send your offers to one of us, or we'll have it on the social media anyway. So you can do it publicly, or you can do it privately, and we'll reveal all in the next month. Since we recorded, there has been a tightening up of the fundraiser concept. The idea of using the red paperclip story might take a bit of explaining. Instead, we've lifted the swap shop concept from our favourite 70s and 80s BBC TV programme, Multicoloured Swap Shop. What do you have to swap for our item? We've also decided that whatever money is raised at the end will be given directly to Click Sergeant. Click Sergeant fights tirelessly to stop cancer destroying young lives. They provide grants and free accommodation close to hospital to help with spiralling costs. Their care teams are on hand to help families with everything from getting benefits to treatment close to home, and they lobby the government to make sure they get the support they're entitled to. Click Sergeant are here to make sure young cancer patients can focus on getting their lives back on track, and you can find them at www.clicsargent.org.uk.
Right then, guys, so well done on that idea, Pete, and see if it takes off. I'd be astounded if it lasts more than two trades myself, but you never know, I'm a bit of a cynic. Right then, on to the quiz then. So all I've got on the show notes is, think it's me, on it, Rich. So if I have no idea who's doing the quiz this month, I've got no idea about what it's about or anything at all, so take it away, whoever is me.
Was that not you written that, Rich?
Nope.
Who wrote that? Or was that left over from last? I have got a quiz if you want one.
It says, think it's me. On it, Rich. That's all it says. What is voting?
Was that copied and pasted from last month and no one...
Yeah, I think it was left in. I think it was left in from last month. Who did it last month?
I'm sure it was Rich. Me last month. I thought Rich, I did last month. I did the droids coins, so I'm not going to write, think it's me. On it, Rich, am I? I did it last month.
You could say, think it's me. On it, Rich.
Yeah. No, I wouldn't have done that.
It is. It's left over last month, which I didn't delete that bit.
Typical Pete.
But I've got one here. I've got
Come
a
on, then. You'll have to save the day.
This is... It's going to be a quick one, but it's going to be a fun one. And it's going to go round robin. It is the quiz from the Return of the Jedi Summer Special, whatever year that was. It's some year. Christ, what year was that? 1984. I actually got stuck on a few of these, but it'd be quick. And we won't go on for 3 hours. Right, let's start with Richard because he's a moaning old goose. You have to get the answer that is written in the book.
Okay.
So none of this whinging about, oh, no, well, it's in my book it was orange.
I'm trying to run upstairs to my collection room for nothing.
You just stay there. Right, Richard, question one. What was the colour of Luke's landspeeder?
Oh, well, it, I would say an orangey brown, but you're going to want one colour on you. Luke's land speeder, I'm going to go with orange.
Incorrect. Two shades of pink. Bad luck. Preston, who drove the land speeder when Luke and C-3PO were looking for R2-D2?
C-3PO.
Well done. You record your own answers here. Let's go Jason. He's probably got one to get that book as well. R2 and 3PO once took a form of transport forbidden to droids. What was it?
A form of transport forbidden for...
Yeah. Let's be quick.
I don't know.
The escape pod, Jason. Come on. Think about Star Wars. Spoons. Oh, well, this
I was going to say Dewback for Jason's one.
Spoons, what was the name of Boba Fett's ship?
Slave One.
Yeah. Right, back to Richard. What ship was Biggs assigned to after graduating from the academy? Well, these are nasty, these are.
Yeah, I think you're someone stitching me up on these ones. What ship was Biggs assigned to?
Yeah, I know. This is one I would never get, but have a go.
Hey,
you're an EU guy.
Yeah, but honestly, they're talking 25 years now. Some of these are
out. This is crazy.
Biggs was assigned to an Imperial cruiser.
Incorrect. It's called
the Rand Ecliptic.
How did you know that?
Hey,
you've got the book. He's got the book. How dare he? Right, Preston, it's you. What vehicles did Luke and Leia steal on Endor?
Speeder bikes.
Yes.
He wouldn't have known that without the book.
Yeah, but there's an extra part. But what were they actually called?
Imperial speeder bikes.
No, Rough Riders, apparently. Very poor. I'm not kidding you.
Well, that's making this
up. I'm not making this up. This is genuine from the book. I've got it in front of me. Page 43.
So you're giving me a point for that or what?
No. Bad luck. Number seven. Jace, isn't it? What model did Luke play with just before cleaning the droids in the garage?
What model?
Model, a little model. What did he have in his hand?
Oh, it was an Imperial shuttle.
Yes, well done, Jason. Was it not a
Skyhopper?
What's in the book? So he's obviously got the book in front of him.
He has obviously got the book in front of him.
I'm not. I thought it was an Imperial shuttle.
Right. Yeah, let's keep going. This is the fun of the book. We are in Spoons. In what type of ship did the Emperor arrive on the second Death Star?
That was an Imperial shuttle.
Well done.
No, Skyhopper.
I like my questions, I must say.
Let's get on. Back to Richard. How were the Rebel transports protected as they left the Hoth system?
Ion cannons.
And?
Oh wait, come on.
And? This is what's in the book!
Launching as many as possible, because there were too many of them to hit.
No, by two X-Wings. Also. So,
Andy gets name the spade, the droid who is seen with C-3PO.
I can't help it. It's in the book.
Yeah, Rich, if you're not good enough at this quiz, it's not really.
You get half a point there. I hope you're counting how many questions you got right. You locked
up. Yeah, but all of them out.
Yeah, you wish. Question number 10. I've forgotten where we're going. It must
That's
be you,
me,
Preston.
I think.
What form of transport brought the two droids to Luke's farm?
Sandcrawler.
Well done.
Star Wars Sandcrawler.
Yeah, well, that's better. He's got the book out, so that's good. Right, we have Mr. Jason. How many skiffs escorted Jabba's sail barge? How many skiffs escorted Jabba's...
Two.
Well done. Look at that, straight in there.
He's got the book. He's got the book.
It doesn't matter. Right, Spoons. When Luke went missing on Hoth, why didn't Han search for him in a speeder?
Because it's too cold.
Yeah, I'll give you that. Richard, what class of shuttle was the Tidarium?
Imperial shuttle?
Oh, what class?
Lambda.
Well done, that's better. I gave you a bit of
help. I'm impressed by that.
But that's good. I wouldn't have known either. So what? Who am I going to next? Preston. Where in Mos Eisley did the Falcon dock?
Docking Bay 94.
Oh, he's got the book. Okay, well done. Right, Jason. What ship reported finding the Falcon in the asteroid field? What's the name of the ship? We know it's a Star Destroyer, but which one?
I'm going to say The Executor?
No, The Avenger. Good guess, though. But you're wrong. And Spoons. What vehicle did Luke destroy with a grenade?
An AT-AT.
Well done. You've got all the easy ones. You've been lucky. Yeah, right, final round. Oh, this is, poor Richard. Name the Counselor ship on a diplomatic mission.
The Tantive IV.
Bit more.
More than the Tantive IV.
What is it?
Frigate.
It's a blockade runner. I'll give you that. Right, 18. Apart from his ship, and this is for you, Mr. Preston. Apart from his ship, what was Boba Fett's personal method of transport?
That's got to be his jetpack.
Well done. Also, rocket pack. I'll give you that. Jason, on which planet did Luke fly a skyhopper?
Skyhopper. This is this skyhopper thing again.
You've been weird with those ones. What planet did he fly one?
Tatooine.
Well done, it's so easy. And finally, Spoons, how did Luke and Leia destroy Jabba's sail barge?
Leia shot the cannon down into the deck.
Well done. Who wins? Probably Preston. Right, brilliant. Let's move on.
Well, that quiz was very fun, very quick. That's exactly what I like, Pete. Well done. Right, actually, you're going to stick with you, Pete, then. So let's move on to shout-outs. What have we found out there in the Facebook and forum world? So, Pete, come on. This thing that you picked up was actually quite interesting. So, come on.
I was quite interested in this. It was by a guy called Tony Soto. I've probably murdered his name. He's given us all permission to use all his pictures. So we'll be putting them in the thing. Because it's quite a weird find. We're thinking, oh, you know, that could be a bit sensitive if he was trying to sell them. But it's quite happy. This is the Star Wars Vintage collectors group. Is that yours, Jason, or is that another one?
No, that's mine's Vintage Star Wars action figures.
State of the war. Right, so he was going off to find some Black Series figures from a guy, and he was trying to get this meeting with him, obviously, you know, because COVID and all sorts, you know, it's been months and months, been trying to set this deal up. And so he finally got in contact with him, and he popped along. He said, oh, yeah, by the way, I've got some old figures if you're interested in them. He said, oh, yeah, I might as well have a look. Turned out to be 12 backs. Oh, OK, yeah, I think I might buy them off you. The condition, they were OK. They're not mint. He said that he could probably grade a couple of them. Might be worth it, but he probably won't bother because it's a lovely little find. But they've all got stickers on from a shop in the States. I've got price stickers on. So I'm assuming they came in the same box. Probably someone in the store couldn't flog them, or they kept them to the side, or they just, you know, decided to keep a collection. But yeah, it was, I mean, just an absolutely outstandingly kind of lucky find. And, you know, what a lovely thing to find. They're all, I believe they're 12 or 12 A's. So unless Jason can tell me otherwise. But yeah, if you've seen the picture, like, what a great find, though. You know, just out of like, oh, yeah, by the way, I've got an entire set of 12 backs lying around. If you want these Black Series figures, what do you reckon the value is on those then, guys? Anyone want to have a quick guess? If you're going to flop those on open market, there's a little bit of damage to a couple of them. One's got a possible top reseal
12,000.
Yeah, I reckon that's probably about generous, $12,000. Anyone else got a different number on that? Yeah, well, there's radio silence.
No, I wouldn't have a clue.
Wouldn't have a clue. Well,
me neither. Sorry.
Go on, Jason. Have an attempt. You're a man who knows his car backs.
I was going to say maybe $15,000-$20,000. They're going to be worth more than that, aren't they?
Yeah, normally the Kenner ones, especially the 12A, seem to go for, you know, around about sort of $1,000, you know, all over the place on that, some of those. Again, it's all on condition. They're all, like I said, I think there's the Han has got. The top of the bubble looks like it's been re-glued in, but the rest of the bubble is fine. There's a couple of little nicks here and there. They're not mint. And see, like I said, you won't be able to grade any of them to any high, decent standard. But I just thought it was a really nice find from someone who wasn't expecting it. And, you know, he's picked up, you know, I mean, it seems like he's going to keep them and put them in his collection. But yeah, I thought that was a cracking little find, that is. Imagine that. Someone said, oh, yeah, but I've got some 12 backs lying around in my cupboard. Let's see. I was just trying to be careful not to sound like I was trying to buy them off him or anything. It's like, you know, we're going to keep them, going to sell them. yeah, what a find.
Yeah, great little find that, and that leads into Rebel Briefings later on with some nice stories. Let's come over to you, Jason. So, Jason, what have you found when you've been perusing the web?
I don't go back to StarWarsForums.co.uk as often as I should, but my featured thing is it's a great little story. I'm just going to read you, and it'll lead into what it is. So this is a post from somebody called Mr. Cutsey. And he says, a few weeks ago, I had my 90-year-old nan round for a Sunday dinner. After dinner, we sat round chatting, reminiscing about me and my cousin when we were young, visiting her and gramps and things we used to get up to on said visits. With my granddad being ex-military, he quite liked the old Action Man figures, outfits and vehicles, and built up quite a collection for me and my cousin to play with whenever we went to visit. So I was asking, do you still have all the Action Man stuff, nan? The answer was no. I found out my cousin had beat me to it and asked this a few years prior to me, took the lot and sold it all. Then our attention was drawn to my Jabba the Hutt playset that is on display on a shelf in my front room. What's that? Is it Star Wars? She asked. Yes, Nan, I've always been mad on Star Wars. Haven't you noticed the display cabinet on the landing with my loose run-in? You've walked past it enough times, I replied. Then she randomly said, I've got a Star Wars figure. Would you like it? I laughed and immediately asked, how old is it, Nan? How long have you had it? She replied, don't think it's very old. Don't remember when I got it. I probably got it for Lewis, great-grandchild, as a present, and forgot about it. Do you want it? Of course, my answer was yes. So fast forward a few weeks to Christmas morning and present opening time. I was sat opening a large box on my old Nan full of treats and bits and like, tins of celebration, bottle of whiskey, bag of peanuts, more various chocolate, etc., etc., and chucked in with it all, a carded Star Wars figure. My heart started racing. I started to freak out. That must be a retro collection figure, surely, I was thinking. Pulled it out, and to my utter amazement, I was holding in my hands a vintage Palitoy Return of the Jedi 65 back Boba Fett space picture figure. So what I believe happened with this figure is that, in fact, it was brought for me in 1983 as an extra Christmas present or birthday present. My nan must have spoken to my mum, told her what she had, and my mum said, he's got that one already. Then it was chucked into the drawer cupboard for 37 years and forgot about it. 100% sure that it was intended for me, as my cousin is a few years older than me and was never into Star Wars toys. Needless to say, I'm over the moon. I have essentially got a childhood figure that's still on the card. He's in pretty good nick, apart from a slightly crushed bubble and minor edge wear. He's my first and only vintage mint on card, as I'm not a carded collector. I still need two figures for my loose run and a couple of weapons, but he will be getting a GW case and take pride of place on top of my loose cabinet. Just thought I'd like to share that story with you. I'll pop up some photos later on, and maybe someone can tell me if he's a 65 back, A, B, C, D, etc., and a rough price so I can shock my old man. Thanks for reading, and Merry Christmas, Dave. And then there's a lovely picture of this 65 back Return of the Jedi Boba Fett. And I'm just reading that story. It just that's such a great collecting story. I wanted to share that with everyone.
Yeah, great story that. Absolutely brilliant. Spoons, you've went somewhere different because we haven't really talked about Instagram much, but you headed down that way, didn't you?
No, I spend more time probably on Instagram than anywhere else these days, actually, for social media. You know, a simple man, nice pictures, can't read the words, you know, that's fine. This is an amazing item, and I don't think I've ever seen one of these before. Not something I've paid a lot of interest in, to be fair, but this is the Empire Strikes Back Play-Doh set, but the Palitoy one. So I think I've seen the bits from these sets, you know, the Star Wars ones, Empire Strikes Back, and Return of the Jedi ones. I think I've seen bits for them for sale. You get the little ships and stuff. But this was a Palitoy one, and I've certainly never seen one of those. And just looking for an image of it online, I couldn't find one. So this is from Darren Simpson, Star Zone Toys. I don't know whether this is for his own personal collection or whether it'll be for sale at one of the shows. Really doesn't matter. It's absolutely beautiful item. It's a sealed Palitoy set, so they're rare enough anyway to find a sealed one. And I don't know if any of you have paid much notice to these, but the it's just crazy. There's the cover shows essentially a toy snow speeder with a Play-Doh, Darth Vader, and Hoth Stormtrooper riding inside it. And the other characters are R2-D2, Luke, and Princess Leia. And whoever's made them, who works for Play-Doh for the covers, done a lovely job, you know, different colours for the feet, the hat and stuff. But they look nothing like who they're meant to be. Luke looks like some kind of Russian guard or something, I think. He's absolutely, absolutely odd. And the other interesting thing about it is that the Palitoy set, they haven't just changed the logo on the front. They've also jazzed up the action set. So this is the Star Wars Empire Strikes Back action set from Play-Doh. So the action set on the Kenner one is just in black lettering, nothing fancy about it. For the Palitoy one, they've changed the writing to red and given it a nice black shadow. I don't think they've done that on any other sets, have they? They just changed the logo, unless they've they've added their own artwork. And it's a complete change, so it's interesting. But absolutely lovely. Not seen one before. Thought I'd give it a shout out.
Yeah, awesome. Right, before I blow you away with my item, Andy Preston, what have you brought to the table?
Cheers, Rich. Yeah, this is something I spotted again on Star Wars Forum UK. This is on the new acquisition thread, page 2467. And this is posted by Kaza, Andy Carrick. And he says, a great start to the new year. Posted in the 2021 collecting goals thread the other day that I was after some diecast, and I managed to get them all in one lot. They're in really lovely condition, and the packaging from the eBay seller was absolutely superb. The Y-Wing and the Imperial Cruiser are complete too, which is always a bonus. And he's put some photos up, and what's really drew my attention to these is that they are in immaculate condition. You almost always find the diecast with some paint rubs and some chips or a bit of yellowing, but these are just beautiful condition. So that the ones he's got, and these obviously are the ones that he needed to complete his set, he's got the X-Wing, he's got the Darth Vader TIE Fighter, the Millennium Falcon, the Y-Wing, and the Imperial Cruiser, which we know better as the Star Destroyer, but in the diecast line, of course, that's what it's called. And, as I say, absolutely mint and complete with the fiddly little bits, the bomb and the Tantive IV with the Imperial Cruiser. And they just look lovely displayed. He's got them in a glass cabinet. Displaying really, really nicely with his others. And, nice to see a bit of love for the diecast. So, as I say, that's what caught my attention this month.
Right. I'm going to put mine in a text chat because I think this is so good for those who have not seen it. Spotted this from Chris Reedy, who posted a Japanese-style holiday special A3 print. It's an unlicensed poster. Put there, I believe it was a timed edition, maybe mistaken, unsure of the final count. Obviously, it's just absolutely brilliant. I love it. The Japanese always do the most amazing things with art, and just look at it, absolutely brilliant. It's obviously done in the same kind of, you know, the Star Wars poster style with the characters and a shape in the background, and I just can't describe enough. I mean, look at Lumpy. Look at Chewbacca's family on there. Luke's absolutely nailed with all his makeup and that on. It is absolutely brilliant. It's such a shame that this isn't a vintage poster, because I think I would like... actually, Andy Spoons, you like your posters. Can you say that up on your wall somewhere?
I could, yeah. That is absolutely brilliant. And it's, I think, Luke's hair. What's happened to his hair? It's just great. And what's the thing... top left that's been shot by a TIE fighter?
It's the Falcon.
Oh, is it? Oh, we're calling it science. It looked like C-3PO wrapped up in cling film.
That's the sort of kinky stuff we don't want to know about, to be fair, I think.
I'm not interested now. No, I can't say that on my wall. But no, it is great, Richard. Great find.
It is. It just makes a smile looking at it. It's got, you know, the Boba Fett animated, Chewbacca's animated... you've got the, I don't know, what's it, the dinosaur type of lizard thing. It's absolutely brilliant. I really, really like that.
That needs to be the DVD cover of when they release the holiday special properly, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely. So some fantastic items there, everybody. I just every time I look at that poster, I just can't help but smile. As bad as the holiday special is, that poster absolutely nails it. Right, guys, that's a fantastic introduction this month, and without much further waffle, let's head over to Rebel Briefings. Mm-hmm.
not one, but two big Palitoy stock finds.
Ooh.
It's in the shopping bag. Kenner coffee table book backed. Dave's New Year's Day big quiz of everything. Star Wars. Cheese labels smell fishy.
The Rebel base is on a moon on the far side. We are preparing to orbit the planet.
Back to number one. Let's go. Richard, you kind of taunted us with this one earlier on. Not one, but two Palitoy stock finds. Now, it sounded like bigger than they were when you kind of put that headline in. I was expecting thousands of things, but not so.
Not so, but it's always nice to go back to, you know, the old days, South Farm UK, and see a couple of nice big stories. So the first one was posted by a user called Keen. This was on the 11th of January. New user, who's only got 38 posts, joined up on January the 6th. And her message was, "Hi guys, I'm fairly new to the site and I found it very informative, thank you. About 24 years, me and my husband purchased clearance stock from a shop in Wales. And with the stock was some Star Wars figures. I opened the mailer boxes, I found this info from your site, left them in the attic until the other day. So I found some vintage rare Palitoy mailer figures. I'm going to put one on eBay to see how the market goes, starting price £45 plus postage. I have five 1984 Ranko keepers, all brand new in sealed bags with mailer boxes, but the boxes differ in condition. I also have two 1983 9-num bagged and boxed. I have three 1980 Dengar bagged and boxed, and two 1984 The Emperor bagged and boxed. They are all bagged and complete. And great the seller in that they advertised and sold these on Stores for UK. Now the bags look absolutely immaculate. They are really, really good. Not many pictures of the boxes, but certainly the Ranko Keeper box, is absolutely trashed on there. But yeah, really, really nice items. The 9-num box looks okay as well. I'm not an expert by any means on Palitoy boxes. So Jason, Andy Preston spoons, any of them four rare? I'm going to guess the Dengar one was the one that people were mostly after there.
Yeah, Rich, the Dengar one's interesting. I mean, you mentioned their 1980 Dengar, but some of the guys more in the know, and certainly more in the know than me, said because it didn't have the writing, I think is it D108 or something like that on the box, that shows a 1980 Empire Strikes Back Dengar mailer. These were apparently from Return of the Jedi era, so a little bit less desirable, but even so, very, very rare, very nice to have. I would have liked to have one of those. I did put some feelers out, but having spent quite a bit over that past week, I did pull back. I didn't actually get one, but I know quite a few other people did. The other ones, the Emperor, I mean, you can get Emperor mailer boxes any day on eBay. Those are really common. 9-num, a little bit less so. Rancor Keeper, that's quite a nice one, quite an unusual one to find. So it's nice to see some of those come up. But all in all, to see that number of mailer boxes all together as a little find coming to SWF UK, as you say, that was that was really refreshing to see that come up, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the second one, also a new user called Charlton, who joined on New Year's Day. "Hello guys, I'm new to the forum. Could somebody please give me a valuation for these items? As you can see, they're all boxed, not played with, and have been in a wardrobe since my childhood. I'm now 43. If someone could kindly help me, that would be great. I also have individual figures and memorabilia from the childhood. Look forward to hearing you, Sean." And straight away, I mean, this is bizarre. A boxed Return of the Jedi AT-AT. What's that still doing in somebody's cupboard? In the wardrobe, untouched from being a kid, now age 43, so it would have been like 6, 7, 8 at the time. Oh, actually, I've said it's untouched there. It is open, the box, although it looks absolutely immaculate. I couldn't actually see it's been taken out the box. You know, still got the insert, still got the instructions, so that looks like it's in immaculate condition.
It's got no stickers on it, has it, Rich?
No, it's got no stickers on, so they're unapplied. Next photo is a Slave One. Again, unapplied stickers. Another boxed Return of the Jedi item, looking absolutely amazing. Then bizarrely, we jump to I'm going to guess that's Power of the Force 2 X-Wing Flight Simulator. Looks very modern. Then we've got an X-Wing, Return of the Jedi X-Wing Fighter Vehicle. Again, unapplied stickers, instructions. I think probably the big gun was the TIE Interceptor. Again, still boxed, unapplied stickers. Then we had a Meccano Jawa 12-inch McConnell Joe, well, whatever size the Joe is, probably 8-inch or so. I believe that was highly popular, and people were debating the price of that range at anywhere from £500 to £1,000, depending on condition. And also turn the Jedi Snowspeeder. Absolutely amazing. Two big finds like that. Well, I know Pete's, you know, drying his tears and saying they're not really that big finds, but the fact is we've got two items here that have been, you know, left for, you know, 24 years for the first one from the shop find, and this one potentially 30-35 years. Absolutely amazing.
Had a horrible thought, Rich. You don't think he opened these boxes, do you, for these photos? Was that discussed?
Well, he hasn't opened the 12-inch Jawa.
Because but you can see that through the window, can't you?
True. Hmm. No, it's not been discussed that at all.
It's the fact that none of them are, you know, you're right. Any kid getting any of these, if they'd open them, would sure, I mean, the look at the Slave One, it's just the wings are still in their bags. And, any kid getting one of these would at least have, you know, if they weren't interested in Star Wars, they would have put one of them together and then got bored and gone out with their football or bike, whatever they were into. But the fact they're all absolutely pristine and they're not a collector just make me wonder whether they've opened them for these. I mean, when it comes to boxed items, I don't think that's a bad thing. I'd much rather see what's in a box than just have a box sealed on the shelf, not knowing even if it was packed correctly back in the warehouse.
Well, they've not opened the X-Wing Flight Simulator, so possibly not. And you look at the tape on the Slave One, and it is yellowed. So you'd imagine that that's probably broken open.
Yeah.
I think they're probably the same as true as the rest items as well. The tape looks absolutely... And he does take a photograph of the tape seal on the Jawa, so he clearly knows something.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah.
That's good. No, just some palpitations there.
Yeah, interesting. Interesting. Yeah, so great to see those not only come for sale on Stars Form UK, but also being sold through there as well. So that's absolutely great. Excellent. You know, long may this continue with new discoveries. Ooh, there's a segue and a half if I heard one. On you go, Pete.
The moon with the Rebel base will be in range in 30 minutes.
Cheeky. It's in the shopping bag. What's in the shopping bag, Richard? What is in the shopping bag? Tell me now.
Yes, this is absolutely amazing, Pete. So if you remember, we discussed a story, it was about a year ago now, whereby a guy from Turkey had drawn some childhood images, and he took photographs of his pencil drawings, and there was a card back of a Stormtrooper, and it was hand-drawn. And it was, you know, hypothesised it was possibly a mock-up that this kid had seen in a shop window, and there was lots of debate about it. Well, the story gets even better now, because a new user has posted on the bootleg group, and we'll come to names in a second, although I'm going to butcher the names. And this is an alleged prototype Uzay card seen in a vintage photo of a group of kids through a carrier bag on a shopping trip. And it's absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. I can't believe that this is found. So what he's posted on there is, this might be interesting, I want to hear your thoughts. A good friend of mine from Istanbul was showing me his childhood photos taken around 1986. We do have the exact date, it is in 1986, but I've got that further down my notes. And they feature his small collection of Uzay figures. He owned three figures during his childhood, Kara Leda, which was Darth Vader, Suruku, which is a driver, and Asuka, which is a Stormtrooper. I probably butchered them three names. And he later sold them to Mete Akin, in the early 2000s, I mean, sadly, obviously, we know that Mete has passed on now. So the first shot involves his Suruku and Kara Leda. Yet it gets interesting with the second photo. This photo was taken in October 1996, on the day his family bought him his Asuka figure from a local stationery store in Turkey. While the figure was an Asuka, the card back inside the bag looks totally different to me. Is it just me, or does this look like the mysteriously early Action Mechanic Robots Uzay card that we know about up until now only existed on the Hoth Troopa variant? Maybe they did more. And that led off to an amazing, amazing discussion on the bootleg group, and I found it absolutely fascinating read. So the guy who actually was in the photograph, and I want to say he's called Kerem, but again, probably butchered that name, so apologies if I have. Hi guys, the person in the photo was me. The package includes a Stormtrooper Asuka figure with a thick black band on the arm. He's my first Uzay figure. I have never owned a snow or hot Uzay figure, because a lot of people had, you know, queried that. The date was October 4th, 1986, and then lots of people did, you know, some amazing stuff on imaging software, you know, zooming in, trying to do color correction, various other things. And then obviously, you know, you've got the hardcore collectors like Joey Glazius and John Alvarez, people like that coming on. So Joe Y was asked his opinion on this, and he hypothesized one of two things. Did SB Products release a small quantity of these as production before changing to the common Uzay cards, and they've all just been destroyed or hidden away in unknown people's homes? Or, because of the proximity to the SB Products factory, the owners, not wanting to be wasteful, may have sent out their mock-ups to stores, either as test marketing or to rid themselves of a design that they had decided that they weren't going to use. Only the owner of the SB Products factory can really clarify this mystery. I know that Lev said that the one that I had was sold to him as a mock-up prototype and is the only example that the owner had left. I'm speculating that the second scenario is what happened, but I'd be ecstatic and broke if another carded example or even a card back surfaced, especially if I had a price sticker for me to store it. So it's absolutely amazing. So for those who aren't aware of what the Action Mechanics robot refers to is, Joe has a Hoth Trooper with, it's a very similar to the Emperor offer on the Return of the Jedi cards, where in the bottom right hand corner there's a yellow strip with Action Mechanic Robots written on the front of it, and they say that's only been found on the Hoth Trooper. So the design of this card is very, very similar to that, but it's clearly not a Hoth Trooper, and it's probably a very, very early Stormtrooper design. So is this another prototype, or is this is this another mock-up that's made its way into a store, or is it actually a range of early designs that were perhaps later destroyed or changed? And one or two people have thought, well, is this because it's too similar to you know, the Star Wars cards, with the, you know, pushing it too far by this point? Who knows, but it's a fantastic story, absolutely brilliant. And so guys, I've got a question for you. I mean, obviously none of us are bootleg, you know, guys, and we're all riding on the shoulders of giants here, but do we need a price sticker to prove that these were shop sold, or is this enough? We've now got the kid with a photograph from 1986 with what looks very, very like one of these in a carrier bag, and then we've got the drawing from a completely unrelated kid who's drawn exactly the same card back, saying that it was in the, I think he put on his, the mid-80s. Do you know, is that enough proof now to say that these were sold in shops, or do we need to find one with a price sticker on them? And if so, you know, what do you think they are? Any thoughts, guys?
I just think we're really fortunate that the kid got his carded figure in a see-through carrier bag. If there hadn't been a see-through carrier bag, we wouldn't be able to see what was inside. So,
well, it's not just that, Jason. It's more than that. It's a see-through carrier bag, but it's also lying in the perfect position to be photographed and see the card back. I mean, it's just amazing.
Yeah, I mean, you don't fake stuff like that. I mean, if the kid's got it in his shopping bag, he's been around the shops, I'm fairly sure it was sold in the shops.
Yeah, I'd go with that as well. And the only other thing would be if he'd met with the owner of the SB Products factory and he'd given it to him, but then surely he would remember that. You know, that would be, you go into some factory, some strange man gives you a toy, it's come from a shop. That's what I would say as well.
Yeah, I agree, it's come from a shop. Could it have been a salesman sample, do you think anything like that would have gone on in Turkey back then? You know, would they have gone round? Or I mean, this shop was very close to the factory, you know, would they have just, you know, rushed product out to shops that are nearby?
I think it's happened before, hasn't it? Didn't some Kenner prototype stuff end up on sale in Australia or something? There was a story I recall. So it's not beyond the realms of possibility that prototype stuff could get out there. And particularly in Turkey with this sort of bootleg stuff, as Joe theorized, that they just didn't want to be wasteful. They had these samples made up and they pushed them out with the regular figures. I can believe that. But having seen the photograph, having seen the image-enhanced version, it looks damn close to me. It's very, very similar to that drawing that surfaced a little while back. So, I'm convinced. I think that's as close as we're probably ever going to get to know that these did make it to retail.
What I particularly enjoyed about this was the whole thread. It was a hark back to the earlier days of discovery and debate. It was absolutely brilliant. So well done for everybody in the bootleg group who chimed in on that. It was a very, very civil conversation with people presenting different viewpoints. Absolutely brilliant. Great to see. I would love to see one of these appear one day.
Death Star approaching. Estimated time to firing range, 15 minutes.
Kenner Coffee Table Book actually got backed, Richard. I think I was the only one who said it definitely would. I don't think it would quite go over, but it did. I said, you know, normally on Kickstarters and fundraisers, you get a big surge at the start, then you get a promotion, and you get a lull, which I think we commented on that there was a lull. They were almost think halfway there, weren't they, when we commented. And then there was that predictable surge at the end where people probably wait to see what the figures were and backed it. So, yeah, what happened then, Rich? How much did they make?
I am glad that the guys have made this, and, you know, hopefully the 995 backers who went forward and pledged a total of £142,973 against a goal of £127,000 get the book and they enjoy it. You know, I wish nothing bad on these guys, but I think the best thing about this is now they're going to stop spamming the Facebook groups because they seem to have disappeared. I'd like to see, you know, one of these books in hand one day, perhaps have a flick through and ultimately decide, was it worth it and have I missed the boat? Interesting to see it's volume one, so more volumes possibly on the way. But yep, nice to see, and hopefully this book is everything that it promises to be when it eventually gets released.
Rich, I think it's worth stating about Kickstarter, because I put a little quote in our show notes, actually. This is from the FAQs of Kickstarter. I'll just read it anyway. Backers must understand that Kickstarter is not a store. When you back a project on Kickstarter, you're helping create something new, not pre-ordering something that already exists. As Kickstarter does not offer refunds, we encourage backers to investigate the project idea first, to vet the creator thoroughly, and to assess the inherent risk of the project for themselves before making a pledge. And that's not to be a scaremonger. That's to hope everyone who invested understands that things can go wrong, costs can go up. They might do a second round of funding if they need a bit more money. Just be wary of that, because, you know, things are changing at the moment, aren't they, with, you know, the way the EU is working because of Brexit. I don't know who their printer is, how they're getting it made, whether they've actually finished it, who they're using. All sorts of things could occur. You know, suddenly the paper stock might go, you know, 2p a page up or something, and suddenly your book's costs go up and they need more money. So just be wary of that before anyone does. Just be wary that, you know, and in future projects as well, that's something to be to know about. You know, I mean, £75 is nothing to be thrown away. Just keep your eyes on that. If you've invested, I'm sure it'll be fine. I'm sure they're going to do a good job. But just keep your eyes on the updates. And also, if you don't get an update and you have invested, please, you know, feel free to pressurise them on an update. There's no reason you can't do that. I'm not picking on them. I think they've done a great job. And that's a lot of backers. Almost 1,000 backers. That's brilliant. I mean, that really is brilliant. That's a lot of people. Not a lot of projects of that kind of, you know, project get that many backers, especially in the UK.
And as we all know, it's everybody who releases books really do respond when people press them to see when release dates or perhaps have been missed by a few years.
Yeah, it can be. I mean, have they put a date on it when they think it's going to be released?
Just March.
This year?
Yeah.
I'll be surprised.
I'm just glad the spam has stopped. It's just been so nice collecting things off the group every other day. So.
Well, you know, they need to get it done. They've done a good job. Fair play to them.
Rebel Base, 1 minute and closing.
Right, Dave's New Year's Day big quiz of everything Star Wars. How'd it go?
It was really nice. What happened was during the summer online event, Dave did a quiz that had technical issues, so most people got kind of dropped out after about the first three questions. He said, we'll run it again a week later. Well, a week later was New Year's Day. So Dave did a New Year's Day quiz. It was really nice seeing him online. Lovely to catch up. And he did his quiz again. And there was maybe about 20 or 30 of us. All the normal quiz stalwarts were there. And Preston was beaten by Newbold in the end by several points.
What? Newbold?
Yes.
Well, they're asking him questions on who was in the last Sky, Rise of the Last Skywalker, whatever it's called.
Oh, I think Preston's got some explaining to do.
Yeah,
Yeah, it was good fun, wasn't it? As you say, it was nice to see everybody. It was nice to have a bit of banter over the text chat, and obviously to see Dave again. Well done to Dave. He put a lot of hard work into it. Hats off to him. Fantastic effort. But in my defense, some of the questions were easy. Some were pretty tricky. I'd like to think I didn't do too badly in those, but some, quite frankly, could have been anybody's guess. How many laser blasts were fired at Slave One as it left Bespin? I mean, who's going to know that?
50 million trillion.
So what? You know, it was a multiple choice. Pick your answer out of four, and there were a few like that, and that's my excuse on those. Guess, hope for the best. I obviously guessed the wrong answer. Yeah. That's my excuse.
Yeah. One of the questions, the answer was Rouge One.
And Admiral Pete popped up again, I think, didn't he?
What?
Yeah, Admiral Pete. Yeah, that was the answer. Definitely.
Yeah, lots of fun. Well done, Dave. Let's have another one.
Rebel Base, 1 minute and closing.
Cheesy labels smell fishy.
Well, yeah, this one's just been sneaked into the show notes. So I'm going to blame Andy Preston for this one. Dairy Lee, obviously the Dairy Lee stickers are incredibly rare. We've known that. I've known a few collectors who are missing one or two to complete sets. And this was a post by Gwan Criddle on the Beyond the Hot Toys Facebook group. And he's posted, can you remember when Dairy Lee stickers were rare and sets were difficult to come across? I'm just amazed how many sales posts there are on this page, especially eBay. 3 sellers selling a set every week. Just feels like a red flag to me, but I don't collect the Ewok stuff. Would be interested in what the community thinks. And then he took a screenshot of some Dairy Lee cheese labels. So we've got one full set, 166.80. Another set sold on 7th of November, 134.40. Another set sold on 30th of December, 125.45. Another set sold on 20th of November, £74. Another set sold on 5th of December, £70.57. And a lot of people have chimed in as to what they think about it. And John Baldwin in particular says, one seller is definitely selling fakes. I messaged him and he blocked me. It was Crimson Crusader 1916. I noticed he was selling multiple full sets. I messaged him and asked. He gave some really short answers. I had a bid to get hold of some and the bid was cancelled. Yeah, what do you think, guys? What's the chances of all of these sets being legit? Andy Preston, I'm going to come to you because I think you're a cheesy guy.
Oh, I'm very cheesy, Rich, as you know. Yeah, I contributed to this thread that Grant put up. It is very suspicious that you've got a seller selling multiple sets. He's using the same image for each auction. And as you say, he's making some good money on them, over £100 in some cases. It certainly looks dubious. I've not seen any of these recent sales or any of the ones that have been sold recently in hand, so I haven't been able to compare them against the ones that I've got. My set was put together one by one over many years, so I'm as confident as I can be that mine are genuine. And as other people have said in the thread, if you look on the reverse of genuine ones, you should see some signs of the factory glue that was put on. There are 3 points of glue in a obviously in a triangle shape on the rear side of the stickers. Some cases it's not very noticeable, but they are there. Other people are saying that if you look very closely at the print on original ones, the characters, particularly some of the text, are really sharp and the fakes are not. But just the mere fact that these have always been so, so rare, so hard to find, and suddenly there are multiple sets popping up all over the place, it just doesn't ring true, does it? I think, as I say, until we've got these in hand, until we can look at them, compare them with genuine sets, we can't say there's a smoking gun. We can't definitively call them fakes, but hey, buyer beware. If it looks too good to be true, it probably is.
We'll be right back.
Well, I'm delighted to welcome Marc Kuin to the Vintage Rebellion for our main interview this month. Welcome to the Vintage Rebellion, Marc.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Now, I'm absolutely super excited for this interview because I've seen some of your collection online and I've been chatting to Andy about some of your collection and it sounds absolutely amazing. So first of all, can we just start off with an introduction to yourself? How have you got involved in Star Wars collecting and can you share some of your earliest childhood memories?
Well, the first good memories that I have of Star Wars when I was about 10. That was in 1983. I'm born in 1973, so that is what in 1983, when the third Star Wars movie came out in the theaters, because Return of the Jedi, that was. And I remember that very well because my parents took me eventually, because I talked every time to my mom or dad I wanted to go to see that movie, because I had seen advertisements in newspapers, or I read the Donald Duck as a child, and also there were all kinds of promos about the new upcoming Star Wars movie. And I really wanted to see that movie, so we drove to Arnhem, that's a city in the middle of the Netherlands. I was living in Zutphen then, that is my hometown. And I remember that very well. My mother fell asleep during that movie, and I was totally overwhelmed, blown away, amazed by all that magnificent movie. And from that time upon, I was totally hooked and wanted to have all the toys and all the stuff that came out. So that was for me the first actually good memory in the theater in 1983.
And so were you aware of the Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back before that, Mark? Is that...
No, not really. I'm sure I've seen some other bits, but it started for me in 1983. So then when I saw that movie, I remember I went to the... I rented VHS tapes because I wanted to see the ESB and A New Hope and play that over again on the television. Yeah, so I didn't get as much as you have, because we have internet now, because back in 83, the world was very much limited or smaller, if you know what I mean. If something happens in the other kind of the world, you immediately know it. But back in 1983, I was only 10, and I didn't get all that stuff known, if you know what I mean.
Well, I think we're the same age, Mark, so yeah, I kind of know exactly where you're coming from there. And so with the toy shops, started getting the figures and things, that would have been at the Return of the Jedi line. Describe a Dutch toy shop in 1983. What's your memory of those?
Every other kid in the Netherlands, you get some pocket money and you went with your pocket money to the shop. And we had a, how do you call it in English? It's a franchise or something like that. Got an intertoy shop. I don't know if you have that open.
I don't think we have that here, but I know, we had some, I know what you mean.
But in every city, there is an intertoy, and they had also a section with Star Wars, I can remember. So I can remember Vivid sitting the large boxes with vehicles in the shop. Also, they had figures hanging on those iron pins. And I do remember the Return of the Jedi cars that had in Holland. We didn't have our own company. We had a Clipper licensee. And I remember having the Return of the Jedi cars, the white Clipper wrap around the figures. And I actually bought some figures. But stupid me, I've ripped the figure off the card and threw the card away, and
that's why we're here today.
If only I had known.
If we kept them all sealed, we wouldn't be here today, I don't reckon.
I do remember, that's also a funny story. We have in Holland, we have Sinterklaas. I don't know if you have that, if you're known with tradition.
Father Christmas, Santa Claus.
But we also have Sinterklaas on the 5th of December. And it's you probably have heard of the discussion with Black Peter and stuff like that, but I don't want to go into that. But as a child, if the Sinterklaas is coming with his steamboat in the Netherlands,
wow.
That is about probably the 28th of November. And from that time on until the 5th of December, people can set their shoe near the fireplace, and you have to put your wish list or a carrot for the horse in it. And then Zwarte Piet comes along that night and he puts some little presents in your shoe. And I got a biker scout figure, but but it couldn't fit in the shoe because of the card. So Zwarte Piet cut the cards around it away, and he only put the blister with the figure in my shoe. So sometimes you see cut cards on the internet or eBay, and well, it probably could have been a gift from a child that has Zwarte Piet has made.
That's interesting. We have stockings, I think, pillowcases and things.
Same here. Case, yeah.
Is this stuff feet related? Well, I don't know.
it's feet related. True.
And going back to the clipper stickers.
Yeah.
I've got a few different ones. I don't really understand that you get sort of one with three stickers on, one with one with two. Got the little catalogs on the back. Do you remember the kind of the differences in the store? If you bought a figure, would you prefer one with a catalog on, or did it really not matter?
For me as a child, didn't matter. I ripped the catalog off, and you can in the catalog you could see you could cut the nameplates away, and in the catalog you could see if you mailed, for example, 5 nameplates, then you get it was for me the Hof playset little bag, but you had backpacks and a couple of gas masks, I don't know. But if you cut out 20 nameplates and you send them in, you get the Darth Vader figure suitcase. Mm-hmm. So that was on the catalog. So you know how many nameplates you have to buy or save for getting the other stuff in.
Yeah.
And I only remember as a child the yellow-black clipper wraps. The white-black
Yeah, okay. Is it the yellow?
Yellow, but I don't have any remembrance of that as a child.
Yeah, and some of them would have been Palitoy cards with the that have been kind of sent over and the stickers put on.
Yeah, I think it all also has to do with cut down cards. You know, the early Star Wars we had. Proper clipper cards, you know, with the proper clipper logo, just like Palitoy. And I think to cut down costs, they took the regular cards and put only a wrap around it, so it was not as it was cost effective. But as a child, I didn't care about the cards or about the boxes. For me, it was all about the toys, you know.
Yeah, I was exactly the same. Of very little memory of the action. You know, I'm asking you these questions. You've asked them, I wouldn't remember. You know, it was just had a Stormtrooper on the front. I ripped it open.
Yeah, that was the first thing you do, right? I must say, if you relate to that, and if you take a look about the collector, I'm happy that later on I didn't sell my collection that I had as a kid. I'm really glad about that, because if you go to high school or college or whatever, most people or many friends I talked about this would sell the collection, but I kept it, and I'm really glad that I still have my vintage figures and vehicles that I played with as a child.
And are they out on display?
Not currently. I have a big display behind me, but that's mainly diecast. I have another room packed full with boxes and some on display. And I have something on display in a museum in the city of Apeldoorn right now. But yeah, unfortunately, that's closed because of COVID. And I don't know when that's going to be opened again, but I'm still thinking about making a proper display room in one of my rooms above.
Okay. Well, that brings us nicely. So, as an adult collector, when did you get that nostalgia bug back? You know, so you've kept your childhood toys are always there. Presumably they're in the laughter in your parents' house somewhere.
Yeah.
What sparked that?
Like I said, if you go to college or when you're further on in your life, you don't care about that stuff anymore, and you go on with different things. But actually, it was my girlfriend or my wife. Then we came across a couple of boxes on the attic, and she said, "Oh, what's this? Oh, it looks really nice. It's a pity it's staying on the attic." And the famous words from her were, "Why don't you put it on a display?" And I think she may regret it a bit now because it's led to the collection I have right now.
And does she have a collection in a different room?
She has her own room. It's packed full with books. She just likes to read. So she has her room and I have my room.
Well, and I noticed recently that you were selling off a Stormtrooper focus run. And
yeah.
I know you for your diecast, which we'll come on to in a little bit.
Yeah.
So that was a fantastic run of Stormtroopers.
Yeah.
You mentioned before that Boba Fett was your favourite character. What led you to start a focus in the first place, and why did you pick the Stormtrooper there?
Well, Star Wars has a couple of figures I really like and are also iconic. For example, for me, that are Darth Vader and Stormtrooper. If you show Darth Vader or a Stormtrooper to, how do you call it, a nitwit, someone who doesn't know anything about Star Wars, and you show him the Stormtrooper, I don't know why, but they recognize it. It's a storm, of it's related to Star Wars. And I just like that figure, so I've built a small collection back then of the Stormtrooper figures. Yeah, I had a Stormtrooper focus. I really liked that figure because it's iconic. And sometimes you have to trim down your collection, because it's getting too much. I have all loose vehicles and all loose figures. I wanted to do the same for the boxes, but you know there is so much out there. So I thought about that and I wanted to trim down my collection. My main focus is now the diecast, and I thought about it, and well, that also about the costs. Some items, the costs are really high, so I sold some of the Stormtroopers to finance other bits for collecting diecast. So that's the main reason. Actually,
very very sensible. Richard would agree with that. He loves his diecast. He finds them fascinating. you're Millennium Falcon. That's what
I will never sell my childhood figures or vehicles or whatever.
Do you remember? So did you have the diecast ships as a child?
As funny as enough, no. So why do you collect diecast then? Would be the next question. I feel that somehow. Well, I'm always looking for. Yeah, niche stuff, is that the right word?
Niche.
I think the diecasts are probably underrated, or how do you say that? Not many people collect diecasts, even in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we only had three diecasts. That was the TIE Fighter, the Landspeeder, and help me out here, what was it?
The X-Wing,
yeah. Those, so it wasn't really a huge part of the Star Wars toys. And also, I think the scale has to do anything with it. If I reflect on it, for me as a child, I collected the figures and I wanted to have vehicles where I can put the figures in. And that wasn't the case with the diecast. But it grew on me as an adult. I really liked the X-Wing and the TIE Fighter, because of how they are designed. Intrigued me and wanted to know more. And I really like it that it's not so widely spread. I could easily find some diecasts. It was fairly cheap compared to if you buy, for example, figures or vehicles that are more mainstream. And that was really the main reason why I started collecting these ships.
And your collection is simply amazing, and some of the items you own must be some of the rarest out there. You mentioned the Clipper Carded stuff.
Yeah.
What they are, you know, in terms of the diecast world, certainly the Land Speeder and the X-Wing are very rare.
Yeah.
Do you have a run of the Clipper cards?
No, unfortunately not. I'm searching my ass off, if you know what I mean. I only have the Clipper TIE Fighter. And strangely enough, that's also the one you see widely spread. I don't come across many Land Speeder or even X-Wings. But I do have a Clipper X-Wing card back. So that's the only two Clippers I have. And I really want to have, of course, the Land Speeder and X-Wing as a Clipper mock. But I don't see them. And I think if you see them, they would fairly cost me a high amount of money.
Yeah. Yeah. And some of the other items I know that you have. Are the mailers, and a nice, you know, if diecast is a niche area, diecast mailers are pushing that niche boundary.
Yeah,
but they're absolutely fantastic. So can you tell us about the mailers you got, particularly your Empire Strikes Back ones?
I'm really proud of that. I'm missing only one diecast mailer, that is the Slave One diecast mailer, and all the other ones are now at UKG at the moment. Because I wanted to have them on display. I didn't like it to have them sitting the ships in the brown paper boxes. So I've sent them all over to UKG in England, of course. And I can't wait to have them back and to display them properly. And I'm most proud of the two ESB mailers, which you mentioned. That is the Snowspeeder and the Cloud Car. Yeah,
and can you describe how most mailers, just a loose ship, some tissue paper in a box. Can you describe those Empire Strikes Back ones? How are they different?
Well, they differ because they are on the card box, and they folded the card box to fit them properly in a small brown paper box. So you get if you you would get. You could get them by the Sears catalogs of the GC Penny catalogs. You could order them, and then you would get the brown box in your home. And like I said, the Snowspeeder and the Cloud Car are the only twos who came on a card back. The other one just came in the brown box and as a loose vehicle. And I can't wait to have them back. And I'm also wondering how UKG is going to display them alongside the box and alongside the catalog.
Have you asked to be displayed folded? Or?
I've asked them to keep them folded. And they were also really tight. I wanted to have to see what cardback they were. I can't remember which cardbacks they were, the backing. But it was really hard to pull the card back flat, if you know what I mean. So also I think it's better to keep them folded, and it's really quite unique in my opinion.
Okay, and just as a sort of last diecast question, and it's leading into your collecting experience, if you go around any car boot sale flea market, you will see Beta, Slave Ones, Snowspeeders, and Cloud Cars,
or non-Star Wars for sale,
just for sale, few pounds, all dented, bashed, paint chipped, and they were sold here on Kenner cards, but never on a Palitoy card. Is that the same in the Netherlands? So although the only Clipper cards are the three you mentioned earlier, if you went to a flea market in the Netherlands, would you see the same, you know, a battered cloud car, to, or were they just not sold there at all?
No. One famous flea market over here in the Netherlands is with King's Day. It used to be Queen's Day, if you know that. All people are going to be dressed in orange, and we have a huge flea market all over the Netherlands. I've searched, of course, in my hometown, but also in other towns, but I've never come across, mostly you can't find any Star Wars anymore. And I can't put the finger behind that. It's also the time where people know, I think, that if you say Star Wars, it's going to be a lot worth of money, if you know what I mean. Incidents do happen. Some people find in a local secondhand shop some Star Wars. But the huge finds or the big dumps of Star Wars goodies, in my opinion, in the Netherlands, that is over. And I'm trying really hard to find some stuff, but it looks like it's being dried out or something. I don't know.
Mark, can I just ask what the vintage Star Wars collecting community is like in Holland? Do you have meetups and are there large groups of collectors? Do you visit each other's collections and things, or is it much quieter than that?
Well, I'm part of the Echo Base Benelux community. That's the largest Star Wars community here in the Netherlands. And it's a really nice group. And we do organize one meeting or twice a year. But because of COVID, everything is on a hold right now. And it's a real pity because that were always really nice events. And I always attended those events. I actually also had a stand or a table, or how you call that in English, to sell some stuff and make some new friends. And I did that together with my brother the last 5 years. So I've attended every Echo Base Benelux meeting. And I also have personally organized two meetings when my collection was on display in my hometown in the Museum of the 20th Century here in Hoorn. They did an exhibition on 40 years of Star Wars merchandise. And they had an exhibition that lasted for about a year and a half. And I organized a meeting at the start of the exhibition and nearly at the end of the exhibition. And many people of the Echo Base Benelux visited that meeting. And, it was a really great atmosphere. And, I really miss those kind of events during this whole COVID thing.
Mark, did with the forums, are you a member of Star Wars Forum UK?
No, actually, that was a bit before my time. I have some remembrance of, I don't know, of the really early internet years, that you had bulletin board systems and you had this 2400 baud modem and you had to log on and everything was really, really slow on your screen. But I wasn't really into Star Wars forums at that time. No.
So it's just kind of the in-person meets.
Yeah, true. And the whole thing grew on me with, the upcoming Facebook and all kinds of Star Wars groups popped up. And now I think I'm really amazed about how many groups there are. Just like our Diecast group, for example. Everybody creates a group about their focus. And I think it's really good and it's really nice because you're meeting with people you can relate with. But if you search on Facebook right now, you get hundreds and hundreds of groups. So I can imagine it feels a bit overwhelming because you don't know what to follow anymore. And if you look at my timeline, well, I'm part of 50 groups or somewhat. So I can't keep up with it anymore, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, no, it's difficult. And which came first, I suppose? Did you get into the Facebook groups by being a member of the Echo Benelux group?
We have a huge second-hand site in the Netherlands. It's called Marktplaats. And I was already looking on that site. It's really the Dutch eBay, if you know what I mean. And there were all some kind of adverts about Echo Base Benelux. So that's why I joined that group. And one thing led to another. And I'm a member of groups in the UK, in the US. And, well, I really like that if someone is selling something in the US, I see that now. And I couldn't imagine 20 years back that would have been the case, you know. So I really like the whole global hobby collecting thing, if you know what I mean.
We have to get the Benelux group over to Britain for a Father's Echo at some point.
I'm part of Echo Base UK, and there's a Palitoy group. Well, there are all kinds of UK groups, and like I said, time is limited, and I don't have any time to also be a part of Star Wars forums that still exist.
That's fine. And you mentioned earlier about some of your collection being in a museum at the moment.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Yeah, well, I don't know exactly, but as I said earlier, my whole time I live in Hoorn, that is in the north of the Netherlands, just about 20 kilometers above Amsterdam. And they did an exhibition about, like I said, 30 years of Star Wars merchandise. So I came in contact with the director of that exhibition. Oh, he said, oh, well, you can join and let's see what you have. And actually, I helped a bit to with the exhibition to put the right figures in the right vehicles and so on. And one thing led to another, because that exhibition lasted about 1.5 years. And then someone from the Space Expo contacted me. That is near The Hague. And that was really cool, because that's near ESA, the European Space Agency, ESTEC, if you know that. And they also wanted to do an exhibition about Star Wars. Some of my collection was displayed there in the museum. It was really cool, you know, near a copy of the Moon Lander and real space stuff. So I really like that. And now, if you in that world, if you know what I mean, then someone else contacts you. Oh, Mark, you have had your collection in Space Expo in Hoorn. Could you do an exhibition at us? So that's why a part of my collection is exposed now in Apeldoorn. That is in the middle of the Netherlands. And they are doing an exhibition that is called Vervente Verzamelaars. And I don't know the right translation, but it's called Avid Collectors. Is that a correct English word? So you have people who collect only Barbies. You have people who only collect Lego. You have people who only collect the Meccano cars. All kinds of specific collections. So you see a small part of my Star Wars collection. You see a small part of Meccano stuff. You see a small part of all kinds of Barbies. You see a small part of gaming computers. A small collection of Furbies. So it's a total exhibition of collecting in the hall. And unfortunately, it's closed during of COVID. It was partially open the last couple of months of 2020. And I don't know when it's going to be reopened, because our lockdown has extended with 3 weeks. And we will see what happens with the exhibition, if they are going to extend it or, can't say. I don't know.
And how did you decide what to send to the exhibition? Is it the same? Is it the same stuff that moves from
the museum? In the Space Expo, I really displayed only a part of my diecast collection and really the spaceships, because the Space Expo is all about space and not so much about the figures. In Hoorn, I I displayed all figures that were ever made, so the whole loose figures, the early birth certificate, and the 12 the display stand, so some kind of highlights for me. And in Apeldoorn, it's all kind of stuff, so not only vintage, but also a couple of modern things. So it really differs per exhibition.
And do you travel with the collection to set it up, or do you trust museum curators?
No, I did that once, and that was a huge mistake, because they thought it was really nice to put a, how do you call that, the backing card on a pin, and that popped out the unpunched card. So that was a good lesson for me, to always do that yourself.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Like you learn.
And so is some of this, some of your collection you've not had in hand then for a year and a half?
Yeah, it travels. But like I said, I don't have a real collection room, and it was already sitting in boxes. So I rather have to it be on display so for people can enjoy the stuff that I have, then put it on in the display room in a box, you know. So.
Brilliant, yeah. And I also saw that certainly one of the museums and you were featured in a magazine.
What's
the story behind that?
Well, it was really a bit a more promotion about the collection and really to attract visitors to the exhibition. But virtually that's not possible at this moment.
That's a shame.
Yeah. I really hope this COVID thing passes away soon.
Yeah, well, another few months. Summer, summer maybe we'll be all right.
Yeah.
And on sticking on that museum theme, so was it a wrench? Have you given the museums or loaned the museums any of your favourite pieces, or do you have your favourites still with you? How do you? I'm just thinking on a sort of personal level. It sounds like a great thing to do.
Yeah.
I would be really torn between my favourite items staying with me here so I could see them, or, as you say, being trusted to some people in a museum and not see them again for a while.
No. For me, it's really to pass on the enjoyment of Star Wars to people who visit the museum and think, oh, well, that's really nice. I'm more that kind of guy. Of course, I enjoy having my stuff, but I also like for other people to enjoy the things that Star Wars has brought us. So the early birth certificate is a high-end item for me, and I really care about that item. But that is currently on display in the museum in Apeldoorn. It's really about sharing the toys and
That's very commendable. That's a good thing to do.
Yeah.
Now we've talked about, you know, you've clearly got a loose collection. You've got your childhood toys. You've got the diecast. I know that you've got some other runs as well. Can you tell us about those? What else do you collect?
I had a Stormtrooper focus, which I have given up. My main focus now is the diecasts, really. But another focus that I have is collecting the Return of the Jedi cards, and only 77 bags and unpunched and no stickers or offers. And I'm about halfway about that run, but it's getting harder and harder to find the correct figures. And those are two basically my main focuses.
Mark, a couple of years ago, there was a huge clipper sale at Vectus Auctions, and I've got a lot of Tri-Logo RFID4s, and the one I'm missing is the clipper one. And I was in a bidding war with somebody who won that, and I'm led to believe that this guy snapped up almost all of the clipper Return of the Jedi cards and Tri-Logos. Do you know if that went back to the Netherlands, or do you just have no recollection of that at all? Because I would like to think that that's gone back to the Netherlands and it's back home.
It wouldn't surprise me. There are, of course, a couple of diehard clipper collectors here in the Netherlands. And now the moment you mention Vectus, I do regret a purchase I missed out on. That was a couple of years ago. There was a die-cast shipping box from Clipper Amsterdam. And I totally forgot about that auction. And I really regret it. If you brought the thing up, I really regret that I forgot about that auction. Yeah.
And going back to your 77 run, that's quite a niche area as well. Mm-hmm. What's tough? What's the toughest ones to find on there? What are you missing?
Well, the early figures like Princess Leia, I've seen a couple, but the harder thing is to find them in a good state. As you know, the Return of the Jedi bubbles are pretty yellow, or they're easily going to be yellow. And the demands that I have are very high. Like I said, they have to be really in really good shape. They have to be unpunched, and it has to be a 77 pack.
Are there any random sort of later characters on the Jedi line or the Empire Strikes Back line that are the harder to find on those?
Yeah, you get a Boba Fett. I've seen that go around for 1,000 and up, you know. So, yeah, I'm willing to pay some kind of money, but, yeah, it has to be on a nice level. How do you call that?
Yeah.
I'm not... some people in the hobby, well, that's also sometimes a frustration. You see people, well, it look like it doesn't care what it costs. They're going to buy it anyway. But that's not in my case. I can't afford to buy the stuff that I want. I really have to pick my my seats, if you know what I mean. Yeah. And that's also part of the fun, you know. If you could buy anything you want, it wouldn't be any fun anymore. And I can wait. It's also really fun to watch and see what happens with some of the stuff that's going to be sold.
Yeah, well, it's an interesting run.
Yeah, thanks.
Mark, I don't know if you can access your Facebook Messenger account from where you are, but I've just put a picture in there that one of our friends had bought, Clipper, Princess Leia, and that was at a fact in, it was a Facts in Belgium. I don't know if you've been down to Facts, and he paid €80 for that. Is that a typical quality image that you'd expect to see for Leia, would you describe in the bad condition?
You sent some picture in the messenger, you said?
Yeah. Right,
let me see.
It's the suntan layer.
Oh, it's really suntanned. Yeah. It's not unpunched, but hey, €80, my God. Yeah, I would definitely grab that one up. Yeah.
Is it a 77 back, that one?
I don't know. I can't relate to it. I all the 77 backs I have, I don't collect any wraps or stickers, or I want them to be offerless.
Mm-hmm. Are there any plans for any kind of virtual conventions or any kind of virtual meetups at the moment? I know you mentioned the Benelux Echo Live events. We've done a few in the UK from Fathers From, where we've still held virtual conventions and things.
Mm-hmm. Now that I'm aware of, it could be that they are planning something, but it hasn't been announced in the group yet, but it could be they are planning that. Yeah.
Well, if you do go ahead with anything like that, just reach out to us and we'll share it with all of our followers. And get the message out there, you know, because the day three Fathers From one, it's difficult for people to get to because it is so far away. But as soon as it went online, you know, it just people from the US and, you know, all over Europe are watching it, so it's a good event.
It sounds like a pretty cool idea.
Well, many thanks for your time, Mark. Absolutely brilliant. I think we're going to get a lot of feedback on this. This one's going to be a popular one.
Okay, thanks. It was good fun. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much, Mark.
Enjoy your weekends.
Yeah, you too.
Okay, cheers, guys. Bye.
Bye-bye.
And now this month's licensee section.
Shiba, Luna, the ending, Tanaku no ninja, Taos, Tokyo, Galactica, Sekai no Aku. Takara. That's how it's pronounced. Believe it or not, I was hoping for something a bit more extravagant.
Sato Vinyl Industries, later to become Takara Corporation Limited in 1966, was a Japanese toy company founded in 1955 by Yasuta Sato from Fukushima. The Takara motto was "Playing is culture," and the name Takara is a girl's name of Japanese origin, meaning treasure or jewel. From schoolgirl-inspired outfits, fearsome fake nails, and blinged-out cell phones, high school girls have always been the frontrunners of obnoxious fashion trends. The post-war generation was no exception, and jumped out of the gates in 1960 with Kinabori Winky, an inflatable vinyl doll that hung on your arm and winked at passers-by with its lenticular eyes. Lovingly christened by the media as Dako-chan, loosely translated as Little Huggums, this innocent black baby rode the arms of schoolgirls across the nation to define a generation. The hottest thing to hit that summer, it was an overnight success and demand far outstripped supply. Storefronts were hammered by waves of customers waiting to buy redemption tickets, which gave them the privilege to line up again later for a chance to buy the actual doll from Takara. Nearly 2.5 million units were moved in just 6 months. Everyone was in love with Dako-chan. Dako-chan was a recognisable logo of the Takara brand. In the 1980s, the company was criticised for using the mascot that was seen as a gollywog-like character. Takara eventually replaced the mascot with 21st century colourful Dako-chan, which had enough features from the original mascot but divested the traits which brought criticism. For example, the new mascot was not always coloured black, maybe missing the point somewhat. Takara produced highly successful brands such as the Microman and Diaclone toys, which were both developed and later picked up by Hasbro to become the Transformers brand we know today. Also, Licker-chan, a dress-up doll series introduced in Japan on July 4, 1967, enjoying the same kind of popularity in Japan as the Barbie series does in the United States, selling over 50 million units as of 2007. They also had the license for Star Wars in the 70s and early 80s. On 13th of May 2005, Takara and Tomy announced their merger. It became effective on 1st of March 2006. In English, the official name of the merged company is Tomy Corporation Limited, while in Japan, the legal company name is KK Takara Tomy. In deciding upon the merged company's new name, Takara was used for its international brand recognition, and Tomy was used because it was a trusted brand of infant and preschool products in Japan. Yasuta Sato passed away on February 26, 2019, at the age of 94. Dubbed the King of Toys, Sato set up the Japan Toy Culture Foundation as a government affiliate in March 1986 with its mission to promote and raise awareness about Japan-made toys. He earned a Doctorate of Engineering from Yamagata University in 2010.
Now, let's have a quick chat about stuff, your Japanese influence as a kid. Now, I remember, I can still see myself sitting there. It must have been a profound thing on me. I still remember sitting there in our sort of utility dining room in my old house with our black and white TV, and me and my brother were waiting for, just after we had our tea or maybe just before, for a cartoon called Battle of the Planets. And I'd never heard of it. My brother would say, oh, gotta watch it. And it must have been hyped up in magazines or comics, something. And that's what kind of got me into that whole Japanese kind of style. It was a Japanese cartoon. Obviously, Starfleet followed. And they made all sorts of cartoons. Ulysses 31 was half Japanese, half French. And my childhood was littered, really, with Japanese influence. Godzilla, monsters, all sorts of crazy TV programs.
Did you watch Monkey Pete?
I love Monkey. Monkey was, again, another favourite of mine. Didn't know whether it was a boy or a girl, a little bold person. We always thought it was a girl. Maybe it was a boy. Tanaka. Yeah. It's a bit like in Battle of Planets, we had Zoltar, who actually in the original Japanese production, because it was obviously an Americanized version of the Japanese cartoon, was actually a transgendered person who did actually change sex or gender, or whatever you call it these days.
I remember Battle of the Planets and used to watch that all the time. The thing that I remember reading about that was in our UK version, we have this scene where it cuts to the underwater base with a little robot yappy dog in it. In their version, they didn't have that at all. They just pulled out lots of swords and stuff and started chopping up their enemies, and there was lots of blood flying on the screen. Obviously, it was kind of like more of a hardcore manga thing. So for the UK, for the children's audience, they just cut all that stuff out and had yappy robot dog talking nonsense when all the big fight scenes were on.
There was a version called Gatcha Man, and it was also called Science Team Ninja, which is a bit strange. But yeah, you can find those on import DVDs and stuff. I think one of my mates has got some of it, and it is weird to watch. It's totally different, how it's set up. There's also quite a strong relationship between the two male leads as well. There's a very strong sexual tension all the way through, that which obviously wouldn't be allowed on British TV in 1980s. But like I said, Zoltar did change gender during the programme. That was completely acceptable. So yeah, Japanese influence and things it was quite ahead of its time, really. And it's taken quite a while for things like those sort of themes to come into things these days. Now, Mr. Spoons, I know full well you're a Godzilla fan. And I bet you love Godzuki as well, didn't you?
I did, yeah. I watched Godzilla and Godzuki. My son is now, he's a massive Godzilla fan. So he liked, in fact, we're watching all the, got him the box set of all the original films, so the Japanese films, got him that for his birthday, so we're working our way through them. He's not shown any interest in Godzuki yet, which I think is a bit of a shame, but all those after school cartoons, I watched them whatever age I was. You get back from school, you don't want to do anything proper, do you? You just watch kids TV.
Yeah, because that whole Godzilla thing, I don't know if anyone sort of a fan of manga and anime and stuff, it all kind of those kind of like dystopian big mechazoid robot death things, it all basically comes from Godzilla was basically the impending doom of nuclear explosion, of America, of the Allies destroying the country, and all those sort of themes have gone on for years and influenced much of the manga style. I mean, there's a really famous anime called Akira, and that's again is very much a sort of, you know, a very dark tale of destruction of major cities. Again, all influenced back to the Second World War. And Godzilla is, it's still popular. It's huge now, isn't it? Godzilla, it was a massive thing. There's yet another film coming out next year, I believe, of Godzilla.
And it's crazy because it's just a monster walking along smashing things. That is the premise of any of those films. People love it.
Or fighting massive moth people, monsters and stuff.
The moth is I've realised working our way through this, I never realised this till now, but Mothma is good. And there's two crazy fairy people that speak for her. You'll have to watch that one.
Yeah, I've always fancied getting there, like the Godzilla kind of like, of the films. So I've tried to pick them up as individual films, but they're usually, daft prices and stuff.
They're expensive.
They are,
which surprised me. But yeah, it's an interesting, and particularly the first one, the 50s one, where Godzilla's dying, and the only way they can get him back, they need him. I can't remember who he's battling in that one, but they need to get him back. And so they basically shoot, it's like a nuclear submarine to him to recharge him. So he's kind of,
again, nuclear power.
Mid 50s, so we're sort of 10-ish years after Hiroshima. So, it must be really fresh in Japanese minds at the time.
Well, it's influence in Thai culture. Preston, you're pretty old.
Yeah, I was there, Pete, but most of what you were talking about passed me by, I think. I watched the cartoons, as we all did. Battle of the Planets really was a favourite. I love that show. Watched Godzilla, but everything else, I must be one of the only people in Britain who didn't get Monkey. Couldn't stand it, didn't get what was going on at all. I think that's about it in terms of Japanese influence on my childhood. I really can't think of anything else.
Richard, Japanese culture. I can't see Japanese culture influencing the north of England. I reckon you'd have been beaten up if you talked about Battle of the Planets and Princess and what that little goosey bloke was called.
No, I absolutely loved Battle of the Planets. It was really good. I had no idea it was Japanese though, until today, because I just didn't care. But yeah, Battle of the Planets was absolutely brilliant. Loved that as a kid. I did like Monkey, although I found it Monkey and Metal Mickey were kind of like a staple of Saturday afternoon, early evening TV shows before Russ Abbott and all the classics came on Friday night, on Saturday night. But yeah, Godzilla, probably not as a kid, because I think they were on at like 2 o'clock in the morning because they were so crap even as a kid, nobody wanted to watch them. But I started to watch like Godzilla and Mothra and things like that, probably more so when I was in my early 20s, when I started to have an appreciation for that kind of stuff. But they're still crap, so I've stopped watching them again now.
It's still crap. I can't believe what you're saying, eh, Spoons? What's going on? But what's wonderful about Takara is the fact that it is a little bit mad. The Japanese influence is fantastic. I think it's really refreshing that, apart from the action figures, which are, you know, the normal size 3.75 inch action figures, everything else has a little bit of bonkersness to it. Now, I think we should start with you, Mr. Spoons, because I was looking around the internet, found this really nice website all about diecast, written by some bloke called Andrew Norton. Really interesting. But I think you've got a bit of a head start on us with this stuff.
I'm not a great language person. Any vintage Star Wars stuff that is in a different language, I just find intriguing and interesting. You know, really, probably really boring if you're from those countries. It just says the same, but in your own language. The sort of the Kenner-esque diecast ships for the for Takari, you just get the Land Speeder, the X-Wing, and the TIE Fighter. But each of those is pretty much, apart from one big difference, which I'll ask you to guess in a minute, but they're pretty much identical to the Kenner cards, except that the names of the ships are written in Japanese script. And that to me is really interesting. Otherwise, they're identical, apart from one thing on the back of the cards. Now, do any of you know what that is?
No idea.
So on the back of the diecast cards, they're really trying to pitch the kid size stuff. So the blasters, the rebel blaster, the Stormtrooper blaster, and the lightsabers. Now, on the back of all the 12 back diecast cards, the lightsaber is yellow, but for some reason on the Takara ones, they've changed it to red, and I've never understood that. So anyone
got any theories? I tell you what, can I add to that? Now, I was going to cover this a bit later, but might as well talk about it now. The electric toothbrush also has a similar thing. So in the same card, the same cartoon on the back, but also, obviously all in Japanese language. But you get two toothbrushes with it. In the Kenner one, the English one, or should we say, English language one, you get a yellow and blue one, I think it is. But the yellow one has disappeared and replaced with a red one for the Japanese one. So there must be something to do with the colour yellow.
Yeah.
How interesting, Mr. Spoons.
Yeah, that's more than coincidence, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. That's a design thing. Something about yellow. They don't like yellow. Maybe it's
just accuracy, as there are no yellow lightsabers in the films.
Perhaps they just love red. Japanese flag's got a big red circle in the middle, hasn't it? Perhaps red is a lucky colour or a favourite colour in Japan.
Under the rising sun, yeah. Mm-hmm. But then the sun is also yellow, so it's very.
That is strange, but that is an odd thing. There must be a reason for that. There must be a reason why Japanese. I'm going to Google it while you keep going.
But anyway, yeah. So that sort of step down the traditional Kenner diecast path has led me down two lines really. So I do really like TIE fighters. So started collecting Takara, Keshigumu rubbers. They're not erasers. They are sort of rubber toys. So I think rubbers is a better name for them than erasers, but we'll come on to them in a little bit. But also any other Japanese diecast stuff. And Takara is such a sort of limited Star Wars run. So late 70s before Popey gets the license. And so it's a really good way of getting a diecast line in general, a good way of getting 12 backs cheap, but also a good way of getting other Star Wars items from that era. So the next ones that I started collecting were I call them the rocket firing range. And there's a bit of debate about what's included in these, but the obvious ones are C-3PO, which I bought these all this year, so I've talked about them on all the shows, so I just whizzed through them. But C-3PO, he's about 6 or 7 inches high and shoots rockets from the middle of his chest. And whilst doing a bit more research for this show, I've found out there's packaging variations. So you get the boxes. I mean, the boxes are really nice looking anyway, but you get them with a sticker, this ST sticker, which is like the LP sticker, LP logo on Kenner's. You get it with a sticker or without, and I think the without is a bit rarer, but you get C-3PO. You get Darth Vader, who doesn't fire rockets, but he has Chewbacca's bowcaster that shoots glow-in-the-dark bolts, so it's kind of a shooting thing, rocket firing, that's what I call him. Also comes with a lightsaber and a cape. And you talked earlier about this robotic look of everything. Now, he looks like a Japanese robot more than Darth Vader. Really big long legs, very mechanical looking, more, you know, I know they say he's more machine than man these days. The Takara Darth Vader looks very much like a machine. There's that kind of four items advertised on the back of these packaging. The other one is an X-wing, a completely different scale, and where the guns are on the wings, you press a button and they shoot off. So it's this rocket firing thing again. And that's really nice. Tiny little R2-D2 that slots in the back. They all come with stands, so they look great on display. And lastly is R2-D2, and there are loads of R2-D2s. Now, the one that I feel goes best with this run is the slide viewing rocket firing one. So you look through his back, you click a button, and you can see various scenes from Star Wars. Then you open a flap on his back, and there's three rocket launchers that come out. You know, that's just a great toy. But you'll get a bit of debate. There's also the standard rocket firing R2-D2, who doesn't have a slide viewer. Some people believe that sort of belongs to this. And that one comes in a couple of different types of packaging. And I've certainly seen I quite like the black. I like Star Wars packaging to look the same. It's the black look of Star Wars that really sets it apart from all the other toys of that time. So you get the rocket firing R2 in the black packaging, but you also get it in a kind of a window box, this white and blue box, which doesn't appeal to me as much, doesn't fit that look so much. But I've seen those for sale quite often farthest from and things. I wonder if they're a little bit more common. Maybe I'll go down that route one day. There's also the battery-powered bump-and-go R2. So you basically turn him on. I remember having cars like this as a kid. Yeah. You turn him on, it hits the kitchen cupboards and turns around and goes somewhere else. And that, you know, that's a great one. And then a little bit like the Kenner or the Palitoy or the Harbour, we've got the remote control R2. In fact, I've got one of those myself. Of course, the Takara one fires discs as well. So the 8-inch disc firing R2-D2. So they're just great, great items.
R2-D2 was a gadgety kind of droid, you know, all sorts of things kind of, and they seem to, I know it wasn't accurate, but they seem to get the sense of R2-D2 more than we did. I mean, what was the best we had? A remote control one that kind of had you could take, obviously, the, you know, the 12-inch one, you had the Death Star plans, and that's about it.
We had the talking one as well, they didn't do anything. As a kid, you know, I wasn't into, you know, you kind of make up your own games as well. I wasn't reenacting the film, and I hadn't even seen Star Wars till after I'd seen Empire Strikes Back. So who knows what R2 did in the first film, but didn't stop me playing with him and having, you know, shooting discs or rockets would have been a great feature.
Anything, because he's got all these panels on him, and as we've seen in the, you know, episode one and two and whatever, he could fly and, you know, shoot things out of all sorts, and even in Empire Strikes Back, he's got a few bit, you know, little gadgets come out of his head. You know, this is a proper Swiss Army knife of robots, isn't it? So anything goes, really. Anything could pop out of R2. So I think the Japanese did a better job. I really do. I think they did a great job on coming up with something a little bit different on R2-D2. That's what he's there for. To do crazy things.
Toys are meant to be played with, and the more that you can do with them, the more play value they have. And that seems to be certainly Takara's model. But on the flip side, the Takara Zetka, which is another die-cast line, and these are probably most similar to the little die-cast key rings. In fact, I think they did a range of them for the Power of the Force 2, that kind of era. You could get little metallic key rings of various Star Wars things. They look very similar to that, but obviously a lot rarer. And they do very little. So for those, you get the land speeder, the TIE fighter, and the X-wing. And the TIE and the X-wing come with little stands. And then you get C-3PO and R2-D2. And these are tiny little things. R2-D2, the TIE and the X-wing are quite common. You see a lot of those. The packaging actually doesn't look 70s. If I saw these in the shop today, they wouldn't look out of place. It's quite different styling to a lot of the other vintage packaging. Still black, though, so I do like that look. But the land speeder and C-3PO are very rare on the Zetka, and I don't think I've ever seen those carded. I've seen opened ones, but not sealed carded. And so they're a nice little run, those ones.
Just give us an idea of prices of these sort of things. What can you find them for, if you can find them? Because I've seen the Zetka stuff quite a lot. I think, especially place at farthest from, I'm sure I've seen them.
Yeah, they range a bit because people chance their arm. But really, I think it's sort of $150 is kind of the most you should be paying for a fairly nice, like a C8 card. for R2-D2, TIE and the X-Wing, you can still get them there. You see them on eBay for $250, and, you know, that's not outrageous, but they tend to sit there a little bit longer. I had no idea what you'd pay for a sealed land speeder or a C-3PO, because it's just not there. So but there's a loose land speeder and a loose 3PO on eBay at the moment. They've been there a long time. They're around about the $500 price, which says to me that's probably more than they're worth, because no one's buying them at that. You know, maybe I don't know if a carded one somewhere between that and maybe $700-$800. I really don't know. But the bigger items, the rocket fire items, they're great value. They are. They're most of them around, you know, complete in a box in nice condition, around $200. They do go up a little bit. I saw the X-Wing. There's one on eBay at the moment. I think it's missing one of its blasters, but it's in a nice looking box. The polystyrene inserts about £150. Yeah, that's a good deal. And
not bad.
Yeah, you keep your eyes peeled. And I think there's a loose X-Wing someone's selling for £70 or so. So they're not, you know, compared to the Palitoys or the Meccanos or other countries' limited issues. Takara doesn't seem to have quite the same attraction, and I've noticed that. I know Jason might be speaking about this later, but even with the Kenner style figures on the Takara cards for 12 backs, they're a reasonable way of getting a 12 back. I think it's cheaper than some other countries, so I don't know why that is. To me, that, you know, that I love them. You know, if they were more expensive, I'd be prepared to. But also the wood kits, which don't seem very desirable at all. So you mentioned that before in the red paper clip. And these are very similar for those of you who've got kids or bought these for nephews and nieces and whatever. You see these wooden models of dinosaurs or maybe planes and things. You slot all the bits of wood together and they make a 3D model. Well, Takara were doing those in the 70s, and you can get the TIE, X-Wing and Landspeeder. You know, they're the three standard Star Wars ships. You can also get an R2-D2, and I've not seen one of those for sale, so I don't have that one. But they're not very desirable. I think I probably overpaid for the ones I bought recently. But there's one of the Japanese collectors, Toru Komuro. He actually gave me my first TIE, which is why I'm quite happy to pass that favor on with a second TIE as part of anything on the podcast. So, and that's kind of started my liking of those kits, because they're great. Again, they're great looking items, great packaging, and it fits in with the rest of the collection. And then we've talked about Keshi Gomu before. These are these little rubber toys that you got in I think it's pronounced Gashapon, which are like gumball machines, or you see them in service stations in Britain now with sort of those plastic balls in a machine, and the kid puts in a pound and gets a bit of rubber tat out of it, keeps them happy for 5 minutes. You could also get them in these blind bags. The packaging for the blind bags was quite nice, Serge. But these, yeah.
Oh, I hate blind bags. The bane of modern collecting is...
They are, yeah.
Let's do a blind box range of toys. Oh, get over yourselves. I'm not spending £80 for one item.
You know, no, well, the beauty of these Takara Keshi Gomu blind bags, Pete, you have the chance to win another bag. You can get a voucher in the bag to win another bag. But if you're, you know, it's pocket money stuff, isn't it? And you get a few in a bag as well. And I hadn't realised this before. There's a few people making these in Japan at the time. So there's Maruka and Morinaga. But I found out that Takara made their rubbers as well. So basically Takara made them and then the others sold them. So Takara's logo appeared there. And actually the sculpts for Maruka and Morinaga were actually better than the ones that Takara is selling out. The Takara ones are a bit chunkier, a bit less detailed. I prefer them, actually. They to me, they look better. But yeah, they're not as accurate. But they do have one of the best and rarest ones out there, which is a Bantha with a Tuscan Raider riding on it. You can also get a Jewback. Now, they're really, really hard to find, but loads and loads of different colours, I think 15 or 16 colours. So, and I've, Andy Takara, who I get a few of mine from, he's put together a run of just green ones of these. So it doesn't matter which brand.
What sort of price is he paying for those sort of things?
Again, it's chain of fact. One, there was one of the Maruka X-Wings I was watching on eBay this week, which was for sale for £14 and didn't sell.
Oh, okay.
And so, yeah, but I think if you buy them off people in the know, you pay a bit more than that. I think the most I've paid for one is probably like £40 or something like that for a slightly rarer one. The Takara ones tend to go for a bit more money. Maruka, I think Andy regularly has sets of four X-Wings or four Y-Wings for £80 or something like that. You know, they're quite reasonable and they're not quite pocket money. But in terms of Star Wars collectibles, there's not a lot that's at that price level these days, is there?
No, not really. I mean, they're kind of beautiful little things. I think I had a big collection of those. They look fantastic at all the colours.
Where it does get expensive, have you seen the header cards from these gumball machines? So it's basically a backing card with Star Wars on and then a kind of random selection of the rubber toys and a die-cast R2 coin holder.
Oh, okay.
And there was one of, I think Andy was selling that as well. I think he had it out for $2,500, and it sold pretty quickly. I don't know if that was what was paid for, and it was a bit dog-eared around the side. Really nice item.
Yeah,
that's where the prices go. But yeah, these rubbers are a fairly common whatever they are, but it's potentially what color you want it. So I saw I can't remember who it was, a post on Facebook recently, someone had finally got the black Y-wing to complete their run of 16 colored Y-wings. So you know, that was it. They were struggling to get a black one, but not necessarily a Y-wing in itself.
Crikey. I was actually going back on the wood kits very, very briefly. Not a lot of Star Wars collectibles in wood, believe it or not. There's my Amidala chair in wood, and then there was not a lot really.
Isn't there like the kids' bedroom furniture?
Yeah, things like that. But there's not a lot of like collectible things, you know.
Pencils, Pete. Pencils.
Pencils, schmencils. Got lead in them. Terrible, can't eat them. But yeah, not a big range of wood Star Wars toys. If you have a wood Star Wars toy, we have forgotten. Let us know. Richard, you like a large item with several inches of girth, don't you? So tell us about the large action figures.
Well, yeah, Pete. I am astounded that I didn't know that in Japan they released two of the 12-inch action figures. I didn't realise they had. Even though I've seen Lee Bullock's presentation at Father's Farm, I completely must have missed this. So Luke and Leia were released in the 12-inch line, large size action figures. From what I can see from reading the SWC and other places, it looks as though they were just the Kenner box items, but it had the nameplate changed. But, you know, I just love Japanese writing. I just love the whole style of it. And I think those, the 12-inch looking layer boxes are looking really nice. But obviously they weren't the only large size action figures. I've seen these Invictus a few times now, the 8-inch action figures. We've talked about these before.
Yeah.
The Stormtrooper one in particular, because obviously we've talked about the misspelled Stormtrooper on the package. Absolutely brilliant. So there were four of these, but also variants to collect as well with spelling mistakes on. So you have Chewbacca, Darth Vader, C-3PO, and the Stormtrooper. But also the variants are Chewbacca, Darth Vader, and C-3PO were also misprinted with Stormtrooper written on them as well. So they're quite hard to get. SWC nails the description, perhaps best known for their odd, almost cheesy appearances. They are great, great action figures. 8-inch lines, it's a bit of an unusual size, yeah. But I do like it. I think it has more playability than the 12-inch line.
Well, it was the Mego size, wasn't it? So it was the same size as the Mego everything, which they've just re-released again.
You know, I think they're absolutely great. Yes, fair enough. You know, they are just scaled up renditions of a 3¾-inch Stormtrooper figure, for example, the Stormtrooper one was. Interesting note, like they made using a pantograph. That would be incredibly tough using a pantograph to scale up a 3¾-inch action figure. But obviously the Japanese are incredibly skilled at that kind of stuff. I don't think I've seen any without cracked bubbles when I think about it. I think all the ones at Vectors I've seen have had issues with the bubbles. But if anybody's collecting those lines, you know, by all means, I'd love to see a group shot of them. They're fantastic items. Love them.
I do love the word Stormtrooper. Sounds like a Geordie version of Stormtrooper. Excellent. Right, Jason, tell us all about Takara, the figure range, the 12 backs.
Right, well, for my source of information, I've gone old school. I've gone to RebelScom. So www.rebelscom.com/JapanSWHistory-Japan.asp page. There's an article that was written back in the day there by a chap called Toro Komuru, and it's called Japanese Star Wars History 101. And I'm just going to focus on the bit about the figures, and this is what he has to say about the figure range. He says, Takara introduced the first line of Star Wars toys in Japan. The original figures were 3¾ inches in size. The packaging was the same as the American versions, except for a sticker about 2 inches in size on the front of the card, which came in a number of different variations. First, they printed a trademark TM with English descriptions, and then changed it to an ST circle, which is the seal of the Japanese company that inspects the safety of the merchandise. I do have a number of these card backs, and on C3PO, I have both versions of that sticker. So I've got a picture with them both side by side that you'll be able to see on the enhanced YouTube podcast for that. Darth Vader's character was even displayed with an all-white background card as opposed to the orange background that was used everywhere else. So, yeah, so behind the bubble, you have the standard colour for the figure. And for some really weird reason, there's a version of Darth Vader which has got a white card in the background, and that's a very desirable card to get. I don't have that as a card back yet. So that's quite unusual for Takara. Even though the major difference between the Takara and Kenner lines was the packaging, three of the actual figures did differ from the American versions, and these were Darth Vader, C-3PO, and Stormtrooper. They used a different mold designed by Takara, was used for all three characters, and they had a screw located on the back of the figure which held them together. So, yeah, they've all got a massive screw hole on the back with a screw in holding the figure together. And it says, even though there were 12 characters advertised on the back of the card, the Jawa and Death Squad Commander were never released by Takara. And those are the ones which on Palitoy arrived on 12-pack, arrived really late in the range. And obviously on the Japanese versions, it was too late to actually make it on to be one of their cards. Also, he says there's no country of origin printed on the back of the cards. So that's quite interesting. The other thing I'm going to talk about.
Jason, just before you go on,
yep.
what sort of prices are you going to pay? I mean, I had a quick look on Star Wars Tracker for Takara cards. I looked at the Vader one. There weren't a lot, but they seemed sort of like, yeah, about just under £1,750 kind of upwards, really, for a carded one. What would you pay for a loose car? Because I mean, I think those cars look great with that sticker on. I think they look absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I got a lot of my cards I got back in the day. So I mean, when I was picking these things up, I'd get these for under £100. I mean, I don't know what they go for now, but a lot of foreign cards for the 12 back, initial run of figures, they all seem to be around the £200 plus mark these days. But they're very nice cards, and they do come up as mint on card quite often, so it's quite easy to pick these things up. And the little sticker is quite nice. And there are, as I say, there are a couple of different variations of that. The other thing that I do want to talk about, which is the same kind of size, is the thing called the Walking Wind-Up R2-D2 Marchant Arrow Monitor, it says in the front of the card. It's a little wind-up R2-T2 that came on a card. And I'm after one of these cards, and I don't have it yet.
Star Wars no R2-D2. Nakonako R2-D2.
Kawaii!
Star Wars no Nakonako R2-D2.
Toru Komuru says about this is, Kenner also produced an R2-D2 figure, which used a sticker to provide R2's details, but Takara decided to give R2 a Japanese touch and provide him with actual detailing in its physical structure. You can tell this is written by somebody who's Japanese. At this time, the R2-D2 toy was rumoured as George Lucas' personal favourite and was ordered and distributed to all employees of Lucasfilm. And it comes in a little baggie, again with the SD logo that featured on the sticker that goes on the front of the Kenner 12-back cards. And in Canada, it actually came on a card that says Walking Wind-Up R2 Marchant Arrow Monitor, and is an actual cartridge figure with a bubble. The Takara version just comes in that little baggie. But it's a lovely little thing, and it means the Japanese say this was called the Noko Noko R2. Noko Noko is the Japanese term used to describe movements of short and heavy objects, and better known in the States as the Winder Party D2, but they called it the Knocko Knocko, so there you go.
That's a cracking little item, that is. Look on eBay, actually, some of the prices for this, yeah, they're huge. You know, there was one, I think it was a graded one, I think, for about £400. Yeah, they want £400 for it, United States. Bit of a shame to see it graded. It doesn't look right.
I've got one, and yeah, and you do need to wind it up and have a go if you own one, and you can't do that if it's yeah, graded.
Yeah, you don't want things graded, goodness sake. The Japanese ingenuity makes something a bit different. R2 did walk. Let's make it properly walk.
Star Wars no R2-D2 wo super controller. スーパーコントロールとは超音波操縦のこと。パワフルな6つのアクション。宝のスーパーコントロール R2-D2。
Right, Jason, lovely little roundup there. Nice one. Especially on those card backs, which I'm sure you'll be looking out for now and losing your money. Preston, let's come to you because I don't know why. I'm sure we've looked at these before, but it never resonated with the name Takara. I didn't realise, but you're going to have a little look at the puzzle boxes, which are absolutely fantastic.
They are, aren't they? Yeah, you've asked me to look at jigsaw puzzles, and Takara did a lot of jigsaw puzzles, more so than any other market, I think.
That's crazy.
Three different sizes. So there were micro puzzles, which were 60 pieces. The big puzzles, 500 pieces. But the ones I'm focusing on today are what they call the mini puzzles, which are 108 pieces. And yeah, these are great, aren't they? There were 8 in total. These were released in 77, 78. Each boxed puzzle contains a jigsaw puzzle and a packet of collecting cards. Very tough set to complete, I understand. The cards and the puzzles are very, very hard to find. So, as I say, 8 in total, and some great graphics on these. So, first one is the award ceremony in the throne room there at the end of the movie. You've then got C-3PO and R2-D2 in the control room on the Death Star. You've got C-3PO and R2-D2 on Tatooine. You've got an image. This is a bit of an odd one. So you've got a composite image of Luke with his land speeder and the droids and the escape pod. I don't know quite how they get those into the same image. But
it looks amazing because you've got a planet in the side. You've got some ship on the background. I can't quite see what it is. That escape pod is half of the image. It's absolutely massive. And, you know, R2 and, like, you know, C-3PO, so, oh, yeah, we came in that ship. That's our ship. It's just, it's amazing. That's just awesome.
Must be the same size as the blockade runner, isn't it?
It is. It's enormous. Huge. Oh, my word. What a great image that is. And it's well done as well, considering it's been cut out and placed on there. That is really well. That's some real nice artistry there.
It is. That's a Photoshop before Photoshop was invented, isn't it?
It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant, that image.
So the other ones that we've got R2 on Tatooine. We've got the Stormtroopers in the Death Star corridor. We've got the Stormtroopers in Mos Eisley stopping the land speeder. And then we've got the X-Wings in the hangar on Yavin 4. So that's the 8. So as I say, each of these, you've got a jigsaw puzzle with 108 pieces. You've then got a set of cards. And these cards, they came in small white envelopes inside the puzzle boxes. There were 5 cards in each envelope, and each is about 2.5 by 3.75 inches, so a little bit bigger than the standard trading cards that we all know about. There weren't necessarily different cards in each different puzzle. Sometimes there were the same 5 that you could get in different puzzle boxes, but they were always together in numerical order in batches of 5. There's a variety of different cards. There's a set of 40 to collect in total, so you've got images from throughout the movie from start to finish. Each box also had inside a much larger black card, about 4 inches by 6 inches, and that had the Star Wars logo on in white text. All the cards, this is going back to the 40 smaller cards now, they've all got Japanese writing on the back and numbers, but no artwork on the backs. The other thing that was inside these puzzle boxes, which intrigued me, on the pictures I've seen, and again, we'll throw this up on the social media and on the YouTube channel, but yeah, there's a little bag full of white powder.
What?
And I thought, what is this? Do they start them young in Japan? What's going on here?
That's shocking. What is going on?
It looks for all the world like something out of Breaking Bad. It really does. But no, it is a small plastic packet of crystals. And apparently the idea is that you mix these crystals with water.
It's not sounding better, Andy, already. You're sounding worse.
And then you spread them over the final completed jigsaw puzzle, and it solidifies. It's like a glue or a glaze, and it keeps the jigsaw puzzle permanently together for display.
What?
How about that? I've never, ever heard of that before.
No, that is mad.
Again, there's a Japanese innovation for you. They were doing it before everybody else, and clearly everybody else hasn't caught up yet.
Well, yeah, I mean, I did a sad story. My nephew loves the Titanic, right? I don't know why. Maybe it's just the impending doom. He just loves the whole thing about it. They're obsessed with it at his school as well. During first lockdown, I did him a nice little jigsaw of a Titanic and stuck it together. I would have loved a little bag of crystal glue stuff. Instead, I had to use tape and glue and all sorts. And did a reasonable job, I've got to say. Quite proud of myself. Like, framed it up for him. He loved it. Thought it was fantastic. You know, he saw the effort went into it. Where's my little bag? They don't do that now.
What happens if you change your mind and want to take it apart again?
Well, you have to cut it up, wouldn't you?
I've got all the kind of UK vintage jigsaws, and I have the ones which feature the action figures. I have them framed on the wall and just pressed inside the display things where you have a kind of cork back and then just a see-through cover on it, and then all the clips in place, and that's enough to kind of hold the whole thing together.
I tell you what, some of those images from the cards, I've got to say, there's a couple of corkers in there. Number 14, I don't know what it is with C-3PO's eyes. So it's Ben helping C-3PO. He's had his arm chopped off by the Tuscans. Luke's got his arm in his hand. And 3PO's eyes are staring quite menacingly into the camera. With his head tilted, it's really quite sinister.
I think yours would be if you just fell off a cliff, Pete.
Well, yeah, exactly. My arm fall off. And I think also number 13 took my eye as well, which was, it was a really cracking image of Mos Eisley. And it's got a very small bantha, or I'm assuming it's a bantha, next to that sort of space pod thing, which is fantastic, outside the, well, I'm assuming it's a canteen or a dwelling. Some really nice images, actually, that again, real interesting selection of images, worth going through. But
Pete, do you not know your Star Wars? That's not a bantha, that's a gerber.
Well, whatever it is, it looks rubbish, and they've just put it on a small pony, let's face it.
Space cow, there you go.
Space shrew, I think. Right! That's a nice, again, a cracking little roundup, Andy. I love the powdered drug bag thing that they found. I asked you also to have a look at some items, just, you know, because there's lots of stuff. Pick up a few oddities, if you wish. I've already mentioned the toothbrush, which is exactly the same in the States as it is in Japan, but all Japanese. The cartoon on the back is absolutely fantastic. Basically, R2 and C-3PO. R2 has grown arms. By the way, Art has got a lovely arm now. He can hold a toothbrush in and clean his teeth. They're chim-chamming about, you know, how to clean your teeth. There's a whole data readout in the cartoon from R2-D2 telling you. It's quite detailed on how to clean your teeth, on to go around the back, on the top, on the side, and to make yourself look really nice with your nice white shiny teeth. And obviously they've used it. They're a bit confused about using it, and Chewbacca comes in, uses it, and there's lots of Chewbacca noises and nonsense. But yeah, the back of the card allows you to send off for more. There's a little address thing on there, same in Japan as well. You can send off for more tooth heads. And as already mentioned, you get different coloured toothbrushes. But yeah, worth checking that out. We'll obviously put it on social media. Fantastic. The only difference is, you know, I said Japanese writing, and obviously rather than Kenner, you've got Takara logo, the little racist logo on there, and the seal of approval. But yeah, a real nice little item. The other item I wanted to mention, which is it's kind of a transforming X-Wing. They called it a transforming X-Wing. Now, I'm going to say it's not technically a transforming X-Wing, even though that they call it that. So it's a really nice kind of like, you know, X-Wing fighter, probably about sort of small kit size you'd get, like an NPC kit kind of size. But what you can do is take out the wings, move them around, create different ships using them. So yes, it is kind of transforming, but yeah, you can pull out the pieces and make a real wonderful variety. So of different spacecrafts. Again, Japanese come up with something a bit different. Some of the designs are absolutely fantastic, but obviously, you know, it was in that kind of era of transforming toys. But yeah, a real beautiful kit. The box is fantastic. It's got its own design on the Star Wars racetrack, all kind of like very zazzy. And it shows all the different types of ways you can transform your X-Wing on there. But yeah, that is that's an absolute corker. Yeah, I really, really think that's one of the most interesting and ingenuitive Star Wars toys out there, really. Any comments on that transforming X-Wing? I think that's brilliant.
It is brilliant. I would like one. But it's just, again, it's just so much play value in there, isn't there? It's in fact, I'm quite tempted to get myself one of these. That's also got the rocket firing guns on the wings. You can see little triggers to shoot off the blasters.
And you get a little blue R2 and a little blue Luke in there. It's quite cute in its own way. sort of sitting there.
The picture on the front of the box is exactly the same as the diecast.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, just with but with the extra shapes that you can make on the side.
Someone's had a right shot at him there on that front of that box. You know, they completely missed, obviously. Don't know where it's coming from. They've had a go, but I do love that different racetrack design. You know, where it's like, you know, real Z-y looking thing. It's quite distracting actually from the word Star Wars, but yeah, it is cool.
And it's big as well, isn't it? It's the size of 3¾-inch ship.
Yeah, it's big. I just love that. I think that's absolutely brilliant. You know, it's got the holes on the sides, so you can pull things out and stick them back in again and all do all sorts of it. But it looked like it came up as a model kit because it had the sprues you had to take it off. So it was kind of, I guess it was just, you know, the way they manufactured it and it was cheap. But
so, Pete, if you had that as a kid, would you have just played with it in X-Wing form or would you have made the other things out of it? It's a little bit like a Lego ship, isn't it? You buy a Lego kit to make a certain thing and then it gives you like the early Millennium Falcons. I think you made the Millennium Falcon and it gave you a design to make something else.
I'd probably had it in blast apart action. So we could, right. You know, so a wing could get taken out by, you know, an enemy ship. I know some of the designs are quite cool. Some are a bit cheesy. The one with the three prongs up. The one that looks like a landing ship is pretty cool with the wings on the side.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. I'd probably do that for like a landing kind of scene in my brain. But yeah, I'd probably done a lot of things being knocked off because, you know, you could pull it apart. But like the X-Wing, you know, you could take off the guns and the compartment and stuff, and I'd have probably had that. And I thought the R2 comes out on this one as well, so, you know, you could be flung out. You're doing your Empire Strikes Back scene, you could fling him out into a pool of dirt. It'd be quite fun. But yeah, love that. Guys, anyway, Spoons, what else have you got for us?
Well, I've picked the inflatable...
It's just straight away inflatable. That's all I need to know. It's inflatable
X-wing torpedo.
Brilliant.
And I've picked it because it's just a bit rubbish. How they tie that in with X-wing? That's got to be a reused toy from another line. Essentially, it does have an X at the very back of it, but it's like the Goodyear blimp. Just a torpedo shape. You inflate it. You throw it. That's the toy here. It's just, yeah, not very good. In fact, it reminds me of the Marvel comic giveaways for issue 1 and 2 with the cardboard X-Wing and TIE Fighter there that don't really look like what they're meant to be because otherwise they wouldn't fly.
It's space, isn't it? So, again, look at the design of the Star Wars on the front, on the side of it. It's got that Z shape on it again.
But the box is kind of more traditional Kenner, isn't it? Could you get a Kenner one of these as well?
I don't know.
I'm not aware of one.
Never heard of that before.
But it's got the same X-Wing image as on the other Takara X-Wing boxes. So that kind of one on its side blasting down, which seems to be typical for these Takara things. But I mean, it's an interesting item. I'm not sure that would be on my list to buy, I must say.
No, but it is one of those oddities that, you know, that sums up the Japanese kind of like, yeah, anything goes. Let's just whack this on the side of it. We got 4 million we made for another line. It didn't sell. Let's stick Star Wars on it, see if we can get rid of them.
But one of the other things I really liked was the R2-D2 pencil sharpener. I was wondering if Andy was going to mention this because with the love of stationery, it reminds me a little bit of the Death Star pencil sharpener from Helix. It comes on a little blister card. Did the Death Star come like that? Or was it just loose?
Death Star was loose. They came in store display boxes, but they were loose in there. It's only the modern 40th anniversary ones that were carded.
That reminded me of those 40th ones because it's sort of a carded pencil sharpener, but it's just a little R2-D2. And we were talking last month or month before about taking things in pencil cases to school. I could imagine having an R2-D2 pencil sharpener and playing with him on my desk when the teacher wasn't looking.
And then shoot some darts at someone's face. It'd be great.
Does this one do anything?
Shoot shavings at your face, you know. Fantastic. I do love anything with that. I mean, that is just a great classic design, isn't it? Especially with the Japanese writing on it. It just looks brilliant. It looks old school. It says anything about the style of Japanese writing. It's almost done in kind of almost like a Star Warsy font as well, the way they've rounded off some of the their own text. So they've been respectful to the design of Star Wars, haven't they?
And they have, and there's, they do a couple of, well, a few badges in similar packaging, and they're quite reasonably priced actually. So, but very, very similar packaging. There's like pin badges, diecast pin badges, and then sort of the more traditional button badge, you know, like the Darth Vader lives. But the packaging is very simple. The items aren't expensive. Just great collectibles. A lot of this stuff, if you found it loose, it's so similar to modern items.
Yeah.
I think you, at first glance, you'd struggle to know what it was actually, whether it's the pin badges, whether it's the Zetka toys, whether it's the 90s Kenner diecast stuff. They all look very similar, I think, out of the packaging.
Let's move on to Jason. I'm hoping that he talks about the action figure display bin, because he didn't mention it in his roundup.
Well, I lost out on one of those on a deal or no deal on Facebook. I was quite annoyed.
How much does that sort of thing go for?
It was relatively cheap again in Display World. So
really,
I bid it up to 300.
Is that all?
Yeah, and then and he said maybe even 305. I think 305, and he said no deal, and I said I'm out, Matt Fox. So he put in a bid at 310. And the guy went, yeah, okay, then. And it was, I'm sure it's only because I said I'm out at 305. He was just trying to see where we went. You know, for the sake of a fiver, it didn't seem much. But yeah, it's gone to a good home, so I'm not.
I mean, just to describe what it looks like, I think I've seen this before, but I can't remember. But sounds a bargain. It's basically a nice big square black box that can take two rows of, or two columns of Star Wars figures, you know, 12 backs. It's got the pictures of the characters on the front in kind of like in a kind of grid format. And the box obviously folds in on itself to create the display. And it's got that Star Wars logo we just talked about with the Zeddy looking Takara. Yeah. I guess it's their trademark almost, which obviously would not be allowed to do today, to have your own kind of styling on there. Yeah, with a nice little movie scene, well, sort of little movie scenes. It just looks, again, another wonderful bit of Japanese ingenuity, the way it folds out. It just looks brilliant. I mean, you could...
And there was questions, when this was for sale, there's actually questions over what it was, because it doesn't immediately look like a bin for carded figures, is it? It looks like something else. This one didn't have the header, to be fair, so it wasn't the complete thing.
But still, even if you just have it, you know, without the header on it, it looks just as cool, because that black box with the logo on. The way they've done the grid of faces is just brilliant. 300 quid. Andy should have put that extra 20 quid in, I think.
Well, I assumed he was like looking for 500 or something. Not an extra fiver, you know.
I would have thought some of that would have gone for a couple of grand, you know.
No, it's a bit like the diecast bins as well. They're not in the same league as Kenner bins. And I wonder whether, you know, a little bit like we saw with Trilogo stuff. Back in the day, can give it away. Everyone wanted Kenner. And it seems to me that kind of ancillary collectibles, the displays, is very much an American bias on that. And I wonder as the years go, or American and figure bias. And I wonder as the years go by, people will get more interest in the foreign stuff, even if they're not from that country. Because for me, that's the attraction of it. It looks different and interesting. Right? It's not a nostalgia thing. I don't even remember displays in Britain. It's just they interest me from a design point of view as much as anything.
Imagine that though, with a full set of your Takaras.
Yeah,
it'd be brilliant, wouldn't it?
It would, but then again, that's odd, because the cards are the Kenner design, aren't they? The racetrack on the cards is the traditional design, whilst the box is the Zeddy type of stuff. It almost deserves a different item. I mean, in fact, actually, the Zetka cards would look much better in there, I think, or the or the rocket fire.
Well, you could put whatever you want in there, Andy.
I would. In fact, yeah, if I had, because not having any Takara 12 backs, if I had won that, I would have put something in there completely different.
Andy, and the other Andy, the P.
Two things that I had found. One is a board game. Now, Takara did do a few board games. I think they had the same ones that Kenner did, but obviously with a little Japanese twist. But there's a little mini board game, which is lovely. And it's the packaging that I really like about this one, as with so much of this Japanese stuff. Now, typical Star Wars, you imagine the packaging to be black. This one is mostly white packaging, but it's got a lot of the elements from the traditional Kenner packaging that we know and love. So it's got the racetrack with a Star Wars logo joining into it. But rather than being the silver on black, we've got the word star is in bright blue, and the word Wars is in bright purple. And then you got a blue and purple racetrack going around the outside of this box. Across the bottom of the box in a diagonal fashion, you've got two green lines, a dark green and a light green, and a picture of the board game below it. Lots of Japanese text. It's just a really nice looking, really odd looking box. And I've got no idea what the board game is. It looks as if it's one where you sort of move your counters around a path, and you know, you perhaps you go forward three squares and back two squares, depending where you land. There's various cards, there's counters. But as I say, I've not seen one that is out of the box, and certainly never had one in hand. So it was the box art that really appealed to me there. The other one that I spotted, and I love this item, I'd love to have one of these, is an inflatable R2-D2 key ring.
What does anyone need with an inflatable key ring?
How bonkers is that? It's just brilliant. Judging by the size of the key ring, I mean, a key ring is about, what, centimetre and a half, something like that. So the R2 must be about 8 or 10 centimetres tall when it is fully inflated. Lovely little depiction of R2. I mean, it looks a bit like the action figure, doesn't it? I don't know whether it's been based on the action figure. But, just a typical bonkers Japanese thing. An inflatable keyring. Who else would think of that? Got it. I've worked out why you need an inflatable R2-D2 keyring.
Why?
If you're going out boating...
Yes.
You don't want to lose your keys.
That's not a bad shout.
You put them on your inflatable R2-D2 keyring, and it falls in... And your keys bob along the surface and you collect them again. They do not sink to the bottom of the boating lake.
And, not being racist or anything, but there's probably more people who are using boats in Japan. You have them, there's a lot of, obviously they're a little island, so there's probably more likelihood you are going to have a need for that sort of thing. So, yeah, that's fair play to them. They've got that right. Yeah, there we go.
Practical as well as beautiful. There we are.
That's the Japanese design, I think. Right, just finally, there was a bot bag and a beach ball, which are, again, completely random. But for some bizarre reason, 3PO's got a rather menacing-looking handgun. Don't know why. He just needs one. You know, they obviously were thinking about this. You know, 3PO's looking a bit too mild and friendly. Give him a gun. Give him a gun. He can shoot people with it. I think that's where we're finished. Guys, that was a cracking little round. Love Takara. Love Japanese items, especially when they use imagination and go for it. Didn't cover everything. We've covered things in the past, like the sort of the version of the NPC kits. Don't go through that again. Wasn't worth it. You can go back and listen to those. But yeah, just a cracking little range. If you've got any of this stuff and you think, we should have mentioned this. I've got this crazy item, or there is something we've missed. Let us know. Send us or maybe send us pictures of your collection. I'd love to see what people have got out there of Takara or other Japanese items, which we welcome to other licensees in the future. So thank you very much, and we'll do another one next month. Brilliant.
Well, I'm delighted to welcome back Marc Kuin for the rapid fire questions. Are you ready, Marc?
Yeah, thanks.
Here we go. What was your first figure purchased as a child?
That was Luke. Luke in the Jedi poncho.
What's your favourite card back image?
Oh, gee. That's a difficult one. I'm torn between... you said the figure, right? I think the Death Star droid.
Favourite figure, vehicle or playset as a child?
For me, the 12-inch Boba Fett.
Oh, wow, I haven't had that one before. Favorite figure, vehicle, or playset now as an adult?
I'm gridding back to the last one. It's going to be my Millennium Falcon.
What's your favorite foreign license for Star Wars?
The Harbour ones.
Yeah, I love Harbour too as well. If you had to have a figure focus, what would it be?
Stormtroopers.
What's your favourite Star Wars movie?
Return of the Jedi.
What's your favourite scene from any Star Wars movie?
The blow up of the Death Star.
What's the favourite convention or event you've attended?
Echo Base Benelux Live.
What's the most boring vintage Star Wars figure?
Anakin.
What is your Holy Grail item?
At this moment, the small winged Darth Vader on the correct card.
What's your favourite character from any Star Wars movie?
Boba Fett.
And if you had to just take one item with you to another planet that you've got in your collection, what would it be and why?
I think it would be my Millennium Falcon that I had as a kid for my parents.
Well, if you're going to take something that big, you might as well chuck some extra things inside it, mightn't you? Well, that's absolutely brilliant, Mark. Thank you for giving your time on the Vintage Rebellion podcast. We're delighted to have you on.
Okay, thanks. Cheers.
Right then, guys. So, on to feedback and goodbyes. Delighted to see that we got a lot of feedback on last month's show, and it was very clear that a lot of people enjoyed the talk that both Marks gave. I was just there to coordinate on the variations. A lot of people have commented on it's nice to focus on the toys because we have diverted away at times, sometimes on purpose, but you know, we will obviously keep nodding back the toys as much as possible. So, starting off with the Jabberwocky on Star Wars Formula UK. Interview with Craig Miller was really interesting. Thanks, Pete, and I really enjoyed the Christmas Sears challenge. Trust spoons to go and cheat. Yep, absolutely right. Rightly eliminated by Andy Preston. The highlight for me was the interview with Mark Baker and Mark Andrews. As a Vaven collector, it's great to hear Vaven collecting on the podcast. In fact, the figures, vehicles, and playsets have seemed to take a backseat for months now, don't get me wrong. I love listening to the Beyond the Toy stuff, and what Jason and Andy don't know about that isn't worth knowing, but the amount of knowledge you bring to the podcast is incredible, and every day is a school day listening to them. It's nice to get back to the Kenner toy line every once in a while. Absolutely. Totally agree with that, Jabberwocky, and we did discuss that before recording this show. Chipsteak, thanks for the great show, indeed a great year of shows. As an ill customer, I've had to shield a lot in 2020. Your hard work is appreciated more than ever. Sweet goodness, your show is great. Craig Miller interview prompted me to dig out a copy of the Sesame Street raw footage, which I saw hadn't made it to YouTube. It does include R2's singing, which Lucasfilm Limited felt too out of character. True to Craig's memory, the skit never made it to the broadcast episodes, so here it is included in the 40-minute footage, but don't get too excited. R2's vocal range consists largely of one note. This boy cannot sing. Anybody who's not checked out Otto singing on YouTube, you certainly should do it. All the best for 2021, Declan. Kato, thanks for the interview, Rich, and the great feedback, guys, such as Mark Andrews. Love getting on the podcast, so I listened to it for a year and finally participating. I was a little worried I jumped into the deep end discussing mixed torsos and mole families. Perhaps I should have done a little introduction to all the terms us variant lot here for granted. Yeah, that's not a bad shout, that, Mark. Perhaps we should have you back on again to discuss some of those topics. And finally, over on Facebook, we can't ignore this comment from Jeff Tilly. I'm glad that'll never come out in the outro. And of course, it gets stuck in the outro. So, what a laugh that comment got from me. Yep, thanks very much, Jeff, once again, for your feedback and support in the Vintage Rebellion. Right, guys, great show this month. Huge thanks to Marc Kuin, but also Andy Spoons Norton, who took lead in that interview, and I thought he did an absolutely stellar job. So, thanks to everybody who takes time to listen to our show. If you want to leave us any feedback, send an email to swtvrpodcast@gmail.com or search Vintage Rebellion on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and everywhere else that will probably exist now that Chris Portley has put on. Once again, huge shout out to Chris for all the videos that he's put on YouTube. Some absolutely stellar interaction going on there, and we seem to have shot up with our YouTube subscribers over the last month or so. Well, guys, really enjoyed tonight. Loved the Japanese section. I found that really, really interesting. Interview with Marc Kuin was absolutely brilliant. So, with further waffle, it's a goodbye from Pete.
Just want to say, the Craig Miller interview was down to Andy Preston. I just joined in. He did all the preparatory work. So, just to make sure you know that. But, yeah, goodbye. I'm going to enjoy the rest of my birthday. All 1 hour and 20 minutes left.
goodbye from Andy Preston.
Cheers, guys. Stay safe, everybody, and may the Force be with you.
Goodbye from Andy Norton.
Sayonara.
Oh, very good. Goodbye from Jason.
Bye, everyone. I just want to say another final happy birthday to Admiral Pete.
And it's a later, guys, from me. And remember,
only you can decide with Star Wars toys. This podcast is not endorsed by Disney, Lucasfilm Limited, 20th Century Fox, or anybody who cares about the Star Wars franchise. It is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. The official Star Wars website can be found at www.starwars.com. All names and sounds of Star Wars are registered trademarks of Lucasfilm Limited and other associated copyright holders. All of the original content of this podcast are the intellectual properties of the Vintage Rebellion. If you enjoyed this podcast, then feel free to email swtvrpodcast@gmail.com. If you don't enjoy this podcast, tough.
Are Star Wars products going to have the durability of, say, that old favourite, the teddy bear?
No way Richard has been up since 5:30. He says he's up at 5:30 every day.
About 6:30 this morning. Yeah, I had a
lot. No way.
I did, yeah.
You look like you've just woken up, Rich. You look.
I always look like I've just woken up.
Says the man in the bathrobe.
Yeah, exactly.
That's my.
Put your dressing gown on properly.
My Jedi bathrobe.
Oh, okay.
It's on a theme. Yeah, I thought. Oh no, there won't be cameras on this because I was thinking I'll put a t-shirt on or something. Rich never bothers with cameras, and there's you two smiling away.
Anyway, back to my story. I almost didn't get to record the podcast tonight because there was this massive, quote, explosion in the office right next to where I'm sitting. I'm looking at this hole in the wall. There's no electrical or water pipes there. I think the wife has just fallen off the seat asleep and crashed into the wall and broken.
What?
Well, she said, it wasn't me. It was the cat. She's blamed the cat so far.
Oh, the cat. It's always a cat. Those cats and their holes in the wall.
Well, there literally is just this huge hole in the wall next to me now.
I mean, is it a hole in the wall that goes out to outside, or is it like a hole in the wall just, you know, the plaster's been damaged?
It's an internal wall. So, I mean, there's the wall on the other side that's on the side where the bathroom is intact. So it's not like you can look through and see someone sitting on the toilet, but...
Oh, this is quality entertainment.
But the thing is, she won't admit to it. She won't admit
it. It kind of narrows it down if there's just two of you and a cat. You know.
Well, she blamed me, and I said, well, you called me and said there's a hole in the wall when I was at work. So it couldn't have been me, could it?
The mystery of Jason's hole. Yeah, don't go through that hole in the wall! He's gone. I've heard him. I heard him go.
Certainly don't grab hold of anything coming through the hole in the wall.
I just heard him. He's stuck between the plaster and the lining. Oh, my. And the breeze blocks. Oh, my God. He's never going to get out. Jason, come back. Oh, dear. Well, I guess we can start divvying up his collection. What do you want out of Jason's collection if you've got to divvy it up?
Comics,
yeah. Well, you're in need a few, so we don't want that. So I'm going to go for his car backs.
Set of 10 Helix felt tip pens for me, please.
Right, I heard you.
He's out of the wall. He escaped. See if Jason come out of his wall.
I'm intrigued. Can we have a photo of this demolished wall, Jason? I'm intrigued.
Oh, yeah, I'll stick that up as well. Hang on. So there's a pencil topper. And the wall, there you go, a picture of the wall. There you go.
Yeah, good fortuna.
Actually, I can probably do better pictures. I was experimenting. I got a light box for Christmas.
Bloody hell, that's a hole in the wall, isn't it?
It's quite a big one, that. Anyway, so now I got a light box, not for Christmas, the Christmas before, but it looks like it'll be absolutely ideal for taking pictures of loose figures and stuff. So I could probably get some really good pictures of that, but...
Looks like a penis.
It does look like a penis. So
I'm just this mysteriously happened, did it?
Mysteriously happened, yeah, it just happened. I'm thinking what I could do maybe is... extend the hole and then put a display case into it and have some loose figures in there. Maybe it's a display opportunity.
Yeah, you could set the case in the wall, have it flush.
Yeah, because there's a good 4-inch gap there. I mean, there's just loads of display space there that I'm just not.
As Rich says, I wouldn't do it to that shape. That would be an odd display.
Not one, but two big Palitoy stock finds. Ooh. It's in the shopping bag. It's in the shopping bag. Crikey, that's a long one. What was there? I missed three, yes. Oh, yeah. Kenner coffee book table backed. Bit controversial, that one. Dave's New Year's Big Day Quiz of Everything, Star Wars.
Pete?
Yeah?
Is it not Kenner Coffee Table Book? Coffee Book Table?
You got Kenner Coffee Book Table. I don't know. Richard wrote it. I'm just reading what he said.
I did.
Yeah, but Jason wrote it. He's from the Northeast. He doesn't know.
Jason wrote it, not me.
You also got the New Year's... You said New Year's Big Day Quiz, not New Year's Day Big Quiz.
God, yeah, those are all my typos. Sorry.
I'm just real. I'm like, you know, what's his name?
No, it's type right. You just said it wrong.
Okay.
This is type wrong because it's coffee book table. This should be coffee table book.
I got all the right words, coffee. But just not necessarily in the right order.
Book.
I was thinking, what the hell's a coffee book table?
Coffee book table? I don't know. I just Richard used to put these bizarre northern puns. I just read them. I'm like the guy from Anchorman, you know, if it's written down.
Yeah, yeah.